Welcome back to Yankee Stadium. We await pitch one of game number two.
E-Trade World Series pregame show is brought to you by E-Trade, the number one rated place to invest online.
The San Diego Padres might trail the World Series 2-0, but you won't know it by listening to the Padre faithful.
I don't care what Steve Lyon says. Padres are going to pick it up.
Padres number one!
And folks, that's no earthquake you're feeling at home. That's Qualcomm Stadium. This place is rocking and ready to go for Game 3 of the 1998 World Series between the Yankees and the Padres. New York with a 2-0 lead, but San Diego hoping to get healthy here at home. Hello again, everybody. I'm Chip Carey, and welcome to the E-Trade World Series pregame show. Folks, Qualcomm Stadium is a madhouse. And who better to talk about a madhouse than my partner, Steve Psycho Lyons. The Padres are happy to be out of New York, and this crowd is the reason why.
Well, they get to come home and play in front of their home fans, finally. I can tell you, it's no fun playing in Yankee Stadium. I was out there. They sing nasty songs about you. They're loud. It's ugly, especially if you're the visitors. Now they get to come home, play in front of the home crowd, and right now they are the loudest crowd in all of baseball.
And the Padres happy they get to finally play real baseball. None of that DH stuff. The pitchers have to hit, and the Yankees insert Shane Spencer into their starting lineup and left.
Well, I am not going to second guess Joe Torre on this one. He put Shane Spencer into the lineup towards the end of the season and in the first round of the playoffs. The guy was an absolute Superman. Then in game one and two of the World Series, he puts in Ricky Lede. Who is Ricky Lede? He turns that kid into a star. Now he goes back to Shane Spencer looking for a little bit of that magic. Spencer's a San Diego kid. He's hoping that he can carry the torch out there in left field again. The big problem, I think, for the Yankees in today's ballgame will be the fact that the 7 and 8 hitters may get pitched around a little bit more than they're used to because Coney, the pitcher, has to hit 9.
And the other story is the condition of the playing field. The Chargers play here as well. They played here Sunday. The field very chewed up. In fact, they had to use 21 gallons of green paint just to make the ballpark look pretty for national television. Might see some funny hops in this ball game here tonight. But again, the crowd is the other big story. It is going nuts here at Qualcomm Stadium, and the Yankees will send their battle-tested veteran David Cone to the mound. He says having postseason experience will be his big ally tonight in Game 3.
Well, I don't know. I think experience plays a factor. 95 in the playoffs in Seattle, I can't imagine an arena being any more noisy than that. The Seattle fans were crazy that year. We've got a few veterans around that have seen some wild playoff-type crowds and World Series-type crowds. I don't know if we've experienced quite what we're going to see here in San Diego, but it should be fun. It's what it's all about. It's nice to see the excitement out here. It's nice to see them get hot for baseball, and it should be a great couple of games here.
So David Cone has been through this before. His opponent tonight, former Yankee left-hander Sterling Hitchcock, has not. However, Steve, what Hitchcock has going for him is a hot hand. He was unbelievable in the first two rounds of the playoffs.
Yeah, he's been a Cy Young killer in the playoffs. He beat three guys in a row. He got Randy Johnson. Then he got Maddox and Glavine of the Braves in three straight starts. So his experience in the postseason has kind of been on-the-job training, but he's absolutely getting it done, and he's got Dave Stewart in his face in case he doesn't.
And he said, hey, to all of his starters, you got to pitch inside. He wants some uncomfortable Yankee at-bats in Game 3 tonight. We'll see if that comes true. The fans are getting comfortable. Hitchcock getting comfortable. Hope you're getting comfortable at home. Our E-Trade pregame show will continue from a raucous Qualcomm Stadium in San Diego right after this timeout.
Your investments help pay for this dream house. Unfortunately, it belongs to your broker. With the new E-Trade, the power is in your hands. The number one rated place to invest online. Now open free to the public with 10 times more research. Free real-time quotes, still from just $14.95 a trade. Sign up now and get $50 free. Hey, now the power is in your hands. E-Trade, someday we'll all invest this way.
Now, Mr. Wells, we're going to monitor your thoughts. Listen carefully. Your boss wants to have a talk with you. You're being audited. It's 110 degrees in rush hour traffic. You're stuck in a used car. Mr. Wells, a used car. Mr. Wells, are you paying attention?
Welcome back to the E-Trade World Series pregame show.
While the crowd in San Diego tries to give the Padres a helping hand before Game 3 of the World Series, Major League Baseball is trying to give those touched by Hurricane George in the Caribbean a helping hand as well.
Major League Baseball has made a donation of $1 million to the American Red Cross for disaster relief in Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic.
Baseball would like to also enlist the help of fans watching this game at home tonight. How can fans at home who want to help those hurricane victims do so tonight?
Well, we are encouraging fans around the world to make their own donation for disaster relief and can dial up 1-800-HELP-NOW. And that will get them to the American Red Cross, and they can make a donation directly in support of the effort in the Caribbean.
Great move by Major League Baseball, and be a clutch pinch hitter as well at home if you can do so tonight. Chip Carey, Steve Lyons, welcome back to San Diego. And speaking of clutch, the Yankees looking to Tino Martinez to recapture his Game 1 magic in this one.
Well, ever since Tino's come to the Yankees, he's led his ball club to three straight postseason appearances. But in the postseason, Tino's always sort of gone away. But there's a saying in baseball that says, let sleeping dogs lie. Guess what? Tino's awake.
Three tremendous seasons here. Not so good in the postseason until right now. Do you know why?
No, I don't know why. It's hard to explain. In '96, I think I just tried too hard. I chased a lot of bad pitches. I was overswinging a lot of times. Coming into '98, I think I just tried to put all that behind me all in one swing and one at bat in the ALCS, and I started fighting those '96 struggles again, and I just wasn't able to relax. And now finally the World Series started, and I just started relaxing a little bit.
We're all hearing the Mo Vaughn rumors. Does it feel like there's a knife in your back after what you've done in this organization to feel like people could just casually say, Mo Vaughn's coming?
No, I thought it was unfair because, you know, that type of stuff, those rumors that happen all the time, no matter what kind of season you have. But it usually comes in the off season. You know, for it to come out now in the World Series where the media has been bombarding me with these questions, it just puts a little extra something in my mind that I really didn't need to think about.
I'm pretty sure you weren't thinking about those rumors when the ball hit in the upper tank there on the Grand Slam.
That felt pretty good. I just felt good to get a key hit to help my team win, you know, in the World Series and hopefully get myself going and carry us to a few more wins here.
Well, Tino Martinez had talked to his wife, and she said, just relax. If you're not in a Yankees pinstripe uniform anymore, then go out and make sure that this is the best World Series you've ever had. And he's feeling better. I'd like to say hello to my dad, who's resting comfortably in an L.A. hospital after not feeling so good. Hope you're enjoying the game and feeling better, Dad.
So get well soon, Mr. Lyons. And, hey, don't forget, the Yankees know all about comebacks. Remember, the Padres may trail them 2-0. The Yankees trailed Atlanta 2-0 and ended up winning the World Series. Tonight's Game 3 could be a big one. Stay tuned. We'll come back, have our national anthem, and get set for Game 3 right after this. Time out.
I snuck to the 63 World Series. Let's go, got on a train. What if I got lost? They may have never found me. I didn't care. I knew Sandy Koufax was pitching, and I was going. And that's all I cared about. And I knew something great was going to happen. When that ball was thrown across and they started jumping up in the air, running across the field, everything went crazy. And as a kid, I'm sitting there going, I'm going to be able to tell my kids this one day. I saw this guy pitch. I mean, spellbinding performances that I've had a chance to see. And the magnitude of being there and seeing what goes on, yeah, sometimes you become overwhelmed. You become a fan.
Back in San Diego for Game 3 of the World Series with our national anthem country music recording star, Trisha Yearwood.
Ladies and gentlemen, to honor America with the presentation of our national anthem, please welcome the musicians who made their triumphant return to Copley Symphony Hall 11 days ago before a sold-out house. Your new San Diego Symphony Orchestra, together with one of America's most popular recording artists. Please welcome Grammy Award winner, Trisha Yearwood.
Saved to Padre owner John Moores. His big donation brought the San Diego Symphony back into play. Stay tuned. Game 3 is coming up next right here on Fox.
I'm Christine Devine. Tonight, a runaway trash truck trashes a Brentwood home with three people inside. Find out what went wrong tonight on Fox 11 News.
Sure, I want to be involved in my investments, but not overwhelmed. Our financial advisor has us where we get what we need to be confident.
Oppenheimer Funds, the right way to invest.
Every generation, every parent, we make every decision based on what's best for our children. We should judge ourselves not by our own success, but by the success of the next generation. I was proud to write California's new textbook law and give every child new books.
I'm Cruz Bustamante. I'd appreciate your consideration for Lieutenant Governor.
Hi, Kevin.
Hi, Kevin. This is my friend Bear. I thought since I'm test driving a truck today, I'd bring a truck driver.
Man, you sure this is a truck?
Thanks, Bear. I tried to tell you.
This truck really drives like, wow, like a Mercedes.
Well, don't drive like no truck I ever been in.
It's the four-wheel independent suspension.
I have been off the road in my truck.
Off the road. There's an idea.
No!
much?
$5.
How much?
$5, ma'am.
Well, get to work. Wow. Kid, you're good.
My pleasure, ma'am.
We didn't invent great service. We just took it to new heights. Alaska Airlines. So much for so little.
You don't need an MBA to know you shouldn't put all your eggs in one basket. The right international funds are a smart way to put some eggs in another basket.
Oppenheimer Funds. The right way to invest.
Don't miss The Simpsons at their special time tonight at 8:30 on Fox 11.
Welcome back to San Diego, California, and welcome to Game 3 of the 1998 World Series here on Fox. The New York Yankees and the San Diego Padres. The fans here making noise, happy to have their Padres back in the World Series at home for the first time since 1984. And welcome to the broadcast booth, everyone. I'm Joe Bock, along with my partners Tim McCarver and Bob Brenly. Well, you know the situation. The Yankees are up 2-0, dominating in game number 2. The come-from-behind effort in game number 1. Tim McCarver, these Yankees, if there were any worries, are playing like a team that won 114 games.
Yeah, Joe, we talked the other night about a 5-tool player, one that excels in all facets of the game. The Yankees are a 5-tool team, and I know they talked about it in the pregame show, but to be more specific, look what the 7, 8, and 9 hitters did in games 1 and 2. Only 455, a home run, 6 RBIs. Scott Brosius tonight will be moved into the number 6 hole, but Shane Spencer, Joe Girardi, and David Cone have not had an at-bat during this World Series, so that puts an awful lot of pressure on David Cone, but he's used to it. That 1-0 in the World Series in 3 starts. Remember that one game that he won in game 3 against Atlanta 2 years ago.
And many people feel that that start and that win for the Yankees turned the tide in the World Series as they went on to win 4 consecutive games. Well, trying to slow down that good offense, tonight's left-handed starter, Sterling Hitchcock.
You know, with all due respect to Kevin Brown, Sterling Hitchcock, without a doubt, has been the hottest pitcher on the Padres staff throughout the postseason. You see what he did against Houston and Atlanta earlier in the postseason. This has to be a concern to Bruce Bochy. He has not gone more than 6 innings in any start in the postseason. We know what's happened when they've gotten into the Padres bullpen. He will have this working in his favor. Look at that background, how bright that is back there. Throwing that split finger out of the brightness of the rail in center field will work to Hitchcock's advantage. He started 2 games in the postseason in the twilight, 1 in the daytime. Bochy said if he holds true to his history, only goes 5 or 6, we'll see Joey Hamilton in the game at that point.
And that's significant because you know what that means? If we see Joey Hamilton tonight, they got the big guy, Kevin Brown, ready for the game tomorrow night, game 4. We get ready for game 3 right now. Coming up, Sterling Hitchcock against David Cone. We're in San Diego. It's loud. This place ready to shake. The World Series game 3 comes your way next.
He picked up his bat. Then he picked up our hearts. Enterprise Rent-A-Car salutes Mark McGuire for picking us all up. Pick Enterprise. We'll pick you up.
This is a world only a few know well. A world of risk and uncertainty. Where the roads can take you to success or prosperity. Or sometimes to no place at all. This is the financial world. For decades, banks and investment firms of mountainous size have ruled the land. Yet, high above the horizon, another mountain has risen. A mountain called First Union. With 16 million customers, the nation's 8th largest brokerage, and 6th largest bank. For a new perspective of the financial world, come to the mountain called First Union. Or if you prefer, the mountain will come to you.
Isn't she lovely? Isn't she wonderful?
over 40 million people worldwide.
The 1998 World Series on Fox is brought to you by First Union, your guide to the financial world. By Enterprise Rent-A-Car, pick Enterprise, we'll pick you up. By Pepsi One, only one has it all. And by Aflac, insuring over 40 million people worldwide.
You think these fans were ready? Watching their Padres fall down 2-0 at Yankee Stadium in New York. All of the headlines, all of the storylines that have followed. The underdog Padres against the New York Yankees. A look at the Coors Light starting lineup for Joe Torre. He leads it off with Chuck Knobloch. Then Derek Jeter bats second at short. It's Paul O'Neill hitting third in right field with Bernie Williams cleaning up in center. Tino Martinez is at first base with Scott Brosius batting in the number six position. Hitting seventh from nearby the suburb area of San Diego, Shane Spencer from El Cajon, California. He gets the start with Joe Girardi batting eighth, catching, pitching, and batting ninth is David Cone. The Padre defense, six errors in 12 postseason games. And this defense backs up the left-hander, former Yankees, Sterling Hitchcock.
The one problem that Sterling Hitchcock could have is high with the fastball in the first inning. And Knobloch will try to take advantage of that. 3-0 in postseason.
The MVP of the NLCS as he beat the Atlanta Braves twice. He won the clincher in game six in Atlanta. And we'll tell you again, the broadcast also available in Spanish by utilizing the SAP button on your television. Glad you're with us for game number three. Chuck Knobloch, strike one. The numbers in the postseason aren't all that great for Knobloch, but in this World Series, 4 out of 7 with a home run and 3 big RBIs. Popped up behind second. Out is Gomez. In is Finley. Steve Finley hangs on for the out. One away.
How about that little dandy for the home folks?
make it fun, Steve. Gets the glove underneath the ball, pops it in the air, tries to barehand it, and traps it against his belly button, but he makes the play.
He ought to get an assist on that and a put out.
Now the key is getting the glove underneath the ball. Keep it from hitting that turf. You never know what might happen.
Great play, great call.
And a look on that final replay that the ball hit leather as he made the sliding attempt. Hung on, one away. The batter is Jeter with O'Neill on deck. Strike one.
You know, Tim, it's always a key for a pitcher to get ahead in the count. It really opens up what you can do with your stuff, but especially for Sterling Hitchcock with that split-fingered fastball. If he can get ahead of the Yankees hitters, force them to the defensive, and then use that split finger to get some swinging strikes, he may cruise early in the going.
One ball, one strike. Home plate umpire from the American League in his first World Series this year is Dale Scott. With DeMuth at first, Sheeta at second, Jerry Crawford at third, Richie Garcia down the left field line, Mark Hirschbeck from the National League down the right field line. Missing low and away to Jeter. Two balls and a strike. Derek, 3 of 9 in this World Series. Joe Torre has maintained consistency at the top of this Yankee lineup with Knobloch leading off and Jeter in the number two spot. Each scored over 100 runs during the regular season. 2-2.
In 4 postseason starts for Sterling Hitchcock, nobody has gotten a hit the first time through the order. First time through the order, hitters are 0 for 24 now with Knobloch's out.
Full count to Jeter.
We talked about that split-fingered fastball from Sterling Hitchcock. When he gets ahead in the count, he'll use that pitch. Also a straight changeup. His fastball's better than you realize. It's sneaky quick because he throws so many off-speed pitches. And more than anybody else in baseball, he gets a lot of swinging strikes on pitches out of the strike zone.
Jeter stays alive.
to reinforce that against the Houston Astros in the division series clinching game. He struck out 11 Astros hitters. Nine of those were swinging strikeouts, and seven of those nine, the pitch never reached home plate, bounced in the dirt out in front of the plate.
Pretty good swing by Jeter as that pitch was up and Derek's eyes lit up and he fouled it straight back.
There's that 0 for 23 coming into the game with 14 strikeouts. Now he has walked three first time through the order, but it's a second time through the order when hitters get used to that split finger fastball that they come around with Hitchcock.
With a moth in the front of his cap, the 3-2 pitch, the one out walk. How about that? Hitchcock had a little friend on his cap when he brought home ball four to Jeter, and a one-out walk gives the Yankees a first inning base runner.
That probably threw off his delivery. That extra weight on the front of his hat there probably threw him off balance and forced him to throw that ball out of the strike zone.
Moff hung in there.
A key at bat by Jeter, because laying off that 2-2 splitter is the reason he's on first base right now.
Here's Paul O'Neill. One on, one out. Just underway in game three. Jeter with a little jab step towards second. He stays put. Ball one to O'Neill.
He tried to get Sterling Hitchcock to balk there. See that move right there? That's designed to get the left-hander to balk.
Well, you see some of that glare out there in center field. It's actually moved up far enough on the hitting background that it shouldn't be too much of a factor in the game tonight.
O'Neill the opposite way. It's a foul ball and will get out of play. One ball, one strike.
As recently as a week ago when we were here for the NLCS, the Sun was very much in play throughout the first four innings of the ball game. But as you can see, only the very top of that hitting background is in the Sun right now, and in another 15 minutes to a half an hour, the hitting background will be completely away from the Sun.
From catcher cam, a look at the 1-1 pitch from Hitchcock to Paul O'Neill. Instead of throw to first.
And I'll tell you what catcher cam shows you there. It might be tougher to catch Hitchcock than to hit against him, because the catcher is looking up higher than the hitter is.
Knobloch fly to shallow center. Jeter drew a one-out walk. And again, a 1-1 delivery instead. Again, throw to first. Jeter doesn't have much of a lead. Back easily. Tim, you mentioned it was an important walk for Jeter in that he didn't offer it that 3-2 pitch. We talked to the Atlanta Braves. Kept trying to tell themselves not to offer it, those pitches out of the strike zone with two strikes.
Right.
Just couldn't lay off, and Hitchcock defeated him twice. The 1-1 to O'Neill is hit hard to short. Gomez starts it. Ferris in the middle. Top of the first is gone. 6-4-3 off the bat of O'Neill. Here come the Padres. Bottom of the first inning. No score.
Stunned. Looking forward to the drive home. Stop commuting. Start driving. Introducing Alero. Alero by Oldsmobile. Start something.
Because there is a man in Chicago planning his retirement this year. Because there is a family in Boston who hopes to send their kids to college someday. Because there is a doctor in New York looking forward to the day she will open her own clinic. Because the dreams of every investor continue to change in a complex world, so too have we. Which is why at Morgan Stanley Dean Witter, we measure success one investor at a time.
Sightings in the skies of the Tower. Car trouble, son?
Yeah, I was just on the internet and
You get the internet on that phone?
Yeah, I email, stock quotes. It's a
pager, too.
The Q phone, the most advanced palm-sized digital phone from Qualcomm.
Weird guy. Cool phone.
The 1998 World Series on Fox is brought to you by Morgan Stanley Dean Witter. We measure success one investor at a time. And by Papa John's. Better ingredients, better pizza.
Around 65,000 fans here at Qualcomm Stadium. Bottom of the first inning, no score. And a look at the Coors Light starting lineup for the San Diego Padres. Gilvio Varas leads off at second. Tony Gwynn bats second and right. Boy, did he get an ovation during the starting lineups here at Qualcomm Stadium, with Greg Vaughn hitting third and left, Ken Caminiti cleaning up at third, Wally Joyner at first, Steve Finley in center, Jim Lehrich, the former Yankee, catching. Chris Gomez is batting eighth, and Sterling Hitchcock is pitching and batting ninth. To look at the Yankee defense, they have made one error in the World Series. We highlight Bernie Williams, and this is a team that is very strong up the middle, especially tonight, with Girardi behind the plate, Jeter and Knobloch up the middle on the infield, and Williams in center field.
You see the numbers on David Cone in the postseason. Fine ERA under three. Averaging a strikeout an inning so far in this year's postseason.
We talked the other night about Kevin Brown and how he is innovative on the mound. Well, here's another Mr. Innovation, a multi-pitch arsenal. He invents stuff on the mound, much like Phil Mickelson does on the golf course. That killer splitter when he is ahead. And still has that knack for making the big pitch. He proved that 2 years ago against Atlanta. That famous conversation on the mound with Joe Torre. 2-1 ball game. He left in the sixth and won it for the Yankees.
There is Kevin Brown, who is getting better health-wise, hit by the flu bug and also hit by a line drive off the bat of Chili Davis in game one. And it looks more and more like he will start here tomorrow night. Win or lose tonight for the Padres. Here's Gilvio Varas with Tony Gwynn and Greg Vaughn to follow. Bottom of the first inning, no score. A strike over the outside corner to Varas. 267 hitter during the regular season. Stole 24 bases during 1998. Two hits and nine at bats in the World Series. One ball, one strike.
We talk about how the Yankee hitters run a lot of deep counts. David Cone runs a lot of deep counts.
Varas showing bunt, taking ball two.
On his last start against the Indians in the ALCS, David Cone threw 103 pitches. The overwhelming majority were breaking balls. He felt he didn't have his good fastball in that game. He's a guy that's very able to go to plan B, plan C, whatever is necessary.
Two balls, two strikes on Gilvio Varas. David Cone talking about Gilvio Varas and how dangerous he is, along with Tony Gwynn. You get Varas on, you can hit and run with Gwynn. You get those two on, then you've got Vaughn, Caminiti, and Joyner coming up. To the shortstop, Jeter. Plenty of time. Leadoff man gone. David Cone takes care of Varas. Will pitch to Gwynn with the bases empty. Tony Gwynn is 4 out of 8 in this World Series. Takes a ball from David Cone. Tony Gwynn, 8-time batting champion, 17 seasons here in San Diego, played collegiately at San Diego State. Into left field, Shane Spencer back to get it, 2 gone.
Well, there's a reason Tony Gwynn has won 8 batting titles. He was out here well before regular batting practice today and had Stan Spencer, a pitcher who was in uniform for the Padres but not on the postseason roster, pitching game situation, throwing breaking balls, throwing changeups, throwing splitters, so Tony Gwynn could wire that swing in just a little bit more.
And who does he go visit? Hitting coach Merv Rettman right after he flies to left. With 2 out, nobody on, it's Greg Vaughn, a 290 hitter. during this postseason. Two out, nobody on, and Vaughn. The line drive caught by Tino Martinez, so the Padres go in order. David Cone starting game three for the New York Yankees. He gets through a perfect first inning.
Been a tradition since 1876. Think about that. That's more than 120 years ago that this company started making Budweiser under Adolphus Busch. The family has always put in the forefront, protect the excellence of the product Budweiser. And I think he would be very happy that the generations of his family have practiced what he taught us.
Boots, villain hat, fat cat, hippie chick, bachelor's turk, disco diva, Gucci shirt, shark skin slacks, gunny sacks, patent leather, boa feathers, hip huggers, dough juggers, brown shoe, red maroon, gonna man, lingerie, saddle shoes.
At the Attic Vintage Clothing Store in Las Vegas, the only thing that's out of style is using American Express. So bring your Visa card. Visa, it's everywhere you want to be.
It's HBO.
My cousin Al still swears he never gets enough to eat. So tonight we took him back to the Olive Garden for more of their never-ending pasta bowl.
It's any special pasta you like,
with all the free refills you want, plus all the salad and breadsticks for $6.95. The Olive Garden. When you're here, you're family.
In just 3 days, all hell breaks loose.
Time to give the devil his due.
Brimstone premieres Friday at 8, 7 Central on Fox.
Well, we showed you Tony Gwynn going over to talk to his hitting coach. Here's what he said to him after that at bat.
Two fastballs.
Forkball. Fastball.
You're right. Huh?
Giddy-up.
No, I know that.
Right at the end of that sound by Tony Gwynn said it, you don't have the giddy-up. It means David Cone is not throwing as hard as Tony Gwynn expected in that first at bat.
Now Bernie Williams leads off here in the second inning.
Forkball and a fastball. The fastball up and out over the plate, and Tony lined it into left field.
One ball, no strikes on Bernie Williams. Now 2-0 as Hitchcock misses high.
It's interesting because usually the fastball in the first inning is, for the most part, the fastball you're going to get in the fourth or fifth. Now, a breaking ball, you can bring that around over the course of the game. Second time through the lineup or later.
Two balls, no strikes. Williams took one over the outside corner, 2-1. Bernie Williams in the second inning. The Yankees leading 4-0. Did this against Andy Ashby. A 3-2 pitch drove it out in right center for the two-run home run. The Yankees were leading 6-0 after two in game two. Here he's up on the count. Two balls and a strike. Three and one from Hitchcock.
It is dangerous to come inside to a hitter like Bernie Williams when Bernie is ahead in the count. Usually if a pitcher is behind in the count, he tries to work away from the hitter. That's a rule of thumb. You don't jam guys on 2-1, 2-0, 3-1 counts.
Full count.
But you can jam them when you're ahead in the count as a pitcher, because the hitter is going to be a little more defensive, try to get a better look at the ball, and that's when you can run that cut fastball right in on the hands.
Struck him out over the inside corner, one away.
That inside fastball with two strikes generally speaking, is a terrific way to work any hitter. The good hitters protect the outside part of the plate. That's why they're vulnerable inside with two strikes.
So Williams is gone. He had the count in his favor, 3-1. He strikes out looking. And now Tino Martinez, who seems to be slowly but surely rounding into regular season form. He had the grand slam in game one, put the Yankees out in front for good. And in game two, he was 3 out of 5.
And a lot more good signs in game two.
Say slowly but surely, slowly, because it's been a long time in coming for Yankee fans and for Tino Martinez, who said after that grand slam in game one, an enormous amount of pressure was lifted, and it showed in game two. The 1-1 pitch, strike two.
I mentioned in game two he showed a lot of good signs. He hit a changeup up the middle of the field. He pulled a fastball into right field. He sprayed a fastball into left field when they tried to work him away, exactly the way a hitting coach would teach you to work your way out of a slump.
Two balls, two strikes. Jam shot into shallow center for Finley. Two down.
Again, coming inside on a Yankee hitter with two strikes as we look at some of the problems that the Yankees have resolved coming into the World Series. In the ALCS, left fielders were 1-for-22, and Chuck Knobloch and Tino Martinez with the 3-run homer and the grand slam respectively in the 7th inning of game one. You can see the Yankee offense in the World Series. Of course, just 2 games, but it's the best 4 out of 7.
Two out, nobody on. And Brocious hitting the number 6 spot, pounds it into center field. Finley didn't get a good read at the beginning and goes back to make the catch to end the inning. A late break, another look back, and the leaping catch to end the top of the 2nd. Bottom of the 2nd, no score.
Something big is happening. Introducing the new Silverado. It's bigger. It's the truck from Chevrolet.
Like a rock. Oh, like a rock.
Babe Ruth is up. He looks sluggish.
Martin, all he's doing is sweating. I'm not sweating and I'm wearing a turtleneck. You're fired.
Jackson's out to talk to Ruth.
What's wrong, babe?
I was out all night, Rich.
Try this. Lipton Brisk Iced Tea.
Ah, that's brisk, baby.
Give it a ride, babe.
Holy cow, what a shot!
Man, with this stuff, I could have hit 80.
Tony, I really think we should rest that arm.
Hey, well, we got to help him.
I'll take that.
Now you got to rest your arm.
Can I get your eyes back, please?
Mr. Tony, rest his arm.
Yeah, honey.
Yeah, I'll be home soon.
Remember what happened last time?
Here comes the choo-choo.
All right, hey, pitch a good one, Tony, you okay?
Hey.
Oh, hey, buddy. Come on.
You got to do it, do it.
You're a better man than I am.
For over 70 years, our business has been helping generations of families live a better life. With retirement plans, life insurance, consumer loans. We're American General Financial Group. 50,000 men and women, over $100 billion in assets, helping over 12 million people live the life they've imagined. American General Financial Group. Live the life you've imagined.
The 1998 World Series on Fox is brought to you by the truck, the new Chevy Silverado, Motor Trend Truck of the Year, and by American General Financial Group. Live the life you've imagined.
What a sight for our sounds of the game. Steve Finley, I'll tell you, we talk about team speed a lot, and generally it applies to running the bases, but Steve Finley was fooled twice on that ball, still able to use that great speed to get back, make that crashing catch against the center field wall.
So the Padres, who went down in order in the first, have Caminiti, Joyner, and Finley. The tangle with David Cone. Caminiti at the very end of game number two took a couple of big swings against Jeff Nelson and tweaked a groin injury. He says, like he always does, that he's fine. But when you watch him take his position top of each inning, he is having a tough time just getting out to third base. But he has convinced Bruce Bochy that he is ready to go. One ball, one strike from David Cone.
The times that you increase the injury prospects, something like that, is when you swing and miss. If you make contact, you don't feel it. If you swing and miss, a chance of hurting it further.
That's foul. Ken Caminiti in game number two, trying to back up Andy Ashby, committed this key error in the first inning. Got to the ball, but the high throw on the ball hit by Paul O'Neill, that sent Chuck Knobloch to the plate and was the beginning of trouble for the Padres in a three-run Yankee first. There's strike three to Caminiti, and he is gone for the first out. Strikeout number one for David Cone here in game three.
David Cone with a splitter down. Splitter in the strike zone. Fastball down that Caminiti pulls foul, and then the somewhat sidearm Laredo breaking ball that started off the outside corner, and Caminiti having a bite.
It's a heck of a toothpick. One out, nobody on for Joyner. He takes low. David Cone is so much fun to watch pitch, and you heard Tony Gwynn say he doesn't have the giddy up. He doesn't have the great fastball that he once possessed. But as Tim, you mentioned early, he is still one of the game's very few big game pitchers. He proved that in 1996, and he backs it up two seasons later in 1998 with another 20-win season, his first since 1988. Ball and two strikes on Wally Joyner.
See 90 miles an hour on that last fastball. That's been his fastest pitch so far in the ballgame.
2-2 on Joyner.
Joe Girardi back there, he would be the first to notice something like that. Girardi's been behind the plate in 30 of 31 starts for Cone this year.
Missing up and in, full count on Joyner with one out, nobody on here in the second.
That's usually your pitcher's best gauge, your catcher.
Mel Stottlemyre, the pitching coach for the Yankees on your right. Now a fan has jumped onto the field. And that will delay play here in the bottom of the second. Let's talk more about David Cone and what he has done in his career in the postseason. Big ERA in the division series. He gets better in the LCS. And a 2.76 ERA with one victory in his career in the World Series as he makes his fourth World Series start here tonight.
Other World Series appearance with the Toronto Blue Jays in 92.
Here's the 3-2 to Joyner. Just up and away for a one-out walk. Cone wanted it. You can't blame him. That barely missed. And Joyner is on with one out here in the second. Folks, for the latest Fox Sports World Series coverage, log on to www.foxsports.com. Sponsored by Qualcomm, which is the name on this stadium now, and it is a stadium packed with just about 65,000 people. As they try to get the Padres off the deck, down two games to none. Ball one to Finley. Numbers in this postseason for Steve Finley, who's 1 out of 8 in this World Series.
We talked about how Steve Finley could come in and go back. This is what he did on Chuck Knoblauch. And then going back on Scott Brosius.
And now on 2-0. 2-1 on a nasty pitch down and away from David Cone.
That's why you can't hit and run against David Cone. He's too unpredictable when he's behind in the count. He rarely gives the hitter a predictable pitch on which to hit and run.
Joyner at first doesn't run all that well. One out. Finley to first. Tino Martinez, nice play to second. Out. Back to first, not in time. And the force out 3-6 for the second out here in the second.
That ball had second and third written all over it.
Tough play for a first baseman. After holding the runner, you shuffle off a couple of steps, and then Finley hits a rocket to him on a short hop. Nice play by Tino Martinez, but with Finley's speed, no chance to turn two on that play. Very little time to react as a first baseman when you're holding that runner on.
So Martinez, a good play for the second out, and now with Finley at first, two down, it's Jim Leyritz. I heard Chip Carey talk about the 20-plus gallons of paint they put on the grass here at Qualcomm Stadium, as the turf here has been chewed up because of football, which is played here. Leyritz, strike one. San Diego State and the San Diego Chargers. And you look at the field as they've tried to make do here with what they have, but it's going to be interesting to track tonight the hops these fielders get off the grass here in San Diego.
I thought Tony Gwynn had a great line. He came out and took a look at the field and said, Natron Means must have had a big day yesterday. They must have been running the ball a lot. This big lineman pushing off.
Finley is running the throw by Girardi, not in time. And Steve Finley gets his first World Series stolen base.
A quick tag by Derek Jeter. It appeared that Finley was out. Another look. Very close. He touched the knee, but did he touch the knee before the foot hit the bag? He was out.
The definitive look on that super shot replay, and Joe Torre is out to argue, and he has reason to be there.
Girardi with a good quick release. Finley appeared to get a good jump at first base. Here you'll see the end of the play. Jeter takes the throw that's a little bit high, slaps the tag down on the knee. Just a split second before Finley was on the bag.
So now the Padres have a runner in scoring position with two down for Jim Leyritz, who has a one ball, one strike count. 2-1.
Tag on the knee just before that front foot got there.
So Finley at second with two down. A three ball, one strike count on Leyritz with Gomez on deck.
Catchers and ex-catchers too love middle infielders that straddle the bag like Jeter did. That gave Jeter the chance to get the call. They didn't get the call, but you love those infielders to straddle the bag as opposed to the infielders who take the throws in front of the bag and then come back. That takes too much time.
Leyritz takes a high strike. He didn't agree, but the count full 3-2. David Cone trying to get around a one-out walk. Later a stolen base by Finley. At second with two down. Inning over. Strikeout for David Cone, his second of the inning, second of the night, no score after two. Back after this from your local Fox station.
I'm Christine Devine. Tonight, a baby is safe at home after a frightening ordeal. Her father's accused of leaving her to search for drugs. Tonight on Fox 11 News.
Sì, lo so che non c'è luce in una stanza quando manca il sole. Se non ci sei tu con me, con te. Sogno all'orizzonte, manca le parole. La mia luna, tu sei qui con me. Il mio sole, tu sei qui con me. Con me, con me, con me.
I just learned Prop 5 guarantees Indian casinos never pay taxes on their profits. No state income tax, no state gambling tax, no local property tax. They'll make over $1 billion a year, tax-free. I pay taxes, you pay taxes, but Indian casinos won't. They'll be the only businesses that'll never pay taxes on profits. Taxpayers, business groups, working men and women oppose Prop 5. It's a special deal for casinos, a ripoff for taxpayers.
For snakes.
I just hate snakes.
Yeah, traveling through Arizona, we blew a front tire. It shot off the road, and I looked down at the ground. It is crawling with rattlesnakes.
It was unbelievable.
I pushed the OnStar button. Within seconds, the OnStar advisor pinpointed our location and sent a tow truck.
Called the paramedics.
Yeah, and kept talking, because we
hate snakes.
Yeah.
The one-touch connection to people who can help.
OnStar.
Call 1-888-ONSTAR-7.
Don't miss The Simpsons at their special time, tonight at 8:30 on Fox 11.
Folks, these aerial pictures are courtesy of the Goodyear Blimp Eagle, based in Carson, California. Goodyear recently increased its blimp fleet to 6, adding 2 airships in Europe and 1 in South America. Beautiful night in San Diego, which is just about redundant. When is it not beautiful here in San Diego? And we had great weather back in New York. The Yankees, with their commanding 2-0 lead, have Shane Spencer in the lineup tonight. Mentioned during the lineup portion, from El Cajon, California, which is straight out Interstate 8, about 30 minutes east of here, and he grew up a Padre fan. Now here he is making his first World Series appearance as a starter here in Game 3 and leading off the third with no score. Strike, and it's 1-2.
You can see the unusual way, especially from our center field camera, how Sterling Hitchcock hooks the ball behind his body on his delivery. He actually tries to do that. He has changed his delivery since coming to the San Diego Padres.
2 balls, 2 strikes.
You know, as a hitter, you look for little things like that. Sometimes guys will tip pitches by hooking the ball on a breaking ball and having their wrist straight on a fastball. Right there in that location, Hitchcock hooks every pitch, so the hitter can't really tell by the grip what pitch he's going to throw.
2 balls, 2 strikes. Spencer, patient, 3-2. What a flourish for Shane Spencer at the end of the 1998 regular season. And for the year, in 67 at-bats, hit 10 home runs, drove in 27, and hit .373. He hit 2 home runs in the division series against Texas. Out in front, struck him out, 1 away, and that's the 2nd strikeout for Hitchcock.
Here's what we're talking about. Sterling Hitchcock, when he was with the Yankees in 1995, had a higher way to come set. He took the ball out right around his chest. Now, compare him to this year, when he takes the ball out of the glove right around the waist. And that's much more deceptive and better control for Sterling than he had 3 years ago.
Girardi now, and Hitchcock misses with ball 1 low.
And the new delivery is much more compact, probably won't generate as much power. You can also see his right leg back in 1995 came behind the rubber before he delivered the ball.
Career numbers with the New York Yankees from 1992 to 95. He's in 59 games and won 16 of them. To the right side for Veras. Two up, two down in the Yankee third. Bases empty, no score with a pitcher David Cone coming up this week. On Fox NFL Sunday, the undefeated Vikings will head to Motown with the Lions coming off their big win over the Packers. Look for their second straight victory over a tough division opponent, plus other regional action. Coverage begins at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific, right here on Fox. Check your local listings.
David Cone may have forgotten that he's supposed to hit. Oh, there he is.
No batting gloves on yet. Had to find a helmet to use. This is not totally strange for David Cone. He's been in the National League. He knows that he anchors that nine spot in the lineup. But for whatever reason, he's very tardy getting up there.
You know, I minored in lip reading in college, and I am guessing, because I can do nothing more than guess, but it looked like he said to Dale Scott when he walked to the plate, I forgot.
Well, at least he has his own bat to use. Not sure exactly how many he has, but he's got at least one.
C-271, that was a bat that was designed by Lou Brock of the St. Louis Cardinals. First time that I ever saw that C-271 was when Lou Brock used it.
One ball, one strike. As opposed to the C-270 or the C-272. Strike two.
Well, they're designed for the hand size. There's Lewis Clark Brock, the Hall of Famer. The hand size, a C-272 instead of a C-271, may have a thicker handle, may have a thicker barrel.
Two out, nobody on. David Cone takes ball two, two and two.
If I'm not mistaken, that C-271 has a little bit of what they call a coned knob. It's appropriate that David Cone uses that bat, yeah. But the handle flares out a little at the bottom where the cone is.
That's right.
And Cone flares one into left field. Back to get it, Greg Vaughn. And Sterling Hitchcock has faced the minimum through three. It'll be Gomez, Hitchcock, and Veras coming up for San Diego. No score.
Your investments help pay for this dream house. Unfortunately, it belongs to your broker. With the new E-Trade, the power is in your hands. The number one rated place to invest online. Now open free to the public with 10 times more research, free real-time quotes, still from just $14.95 a trade. Sign up now and get $50 free. Hey, now the power's in your hands. E-Trade, someday we'll all invest this way.
55. What'll it be?
We'll take some rice and...
Get some Favre, too.
Yeah.
Now you can choose which teams you see every Sunday with DirecTV and NFL Sunday Ticket. There's up to 13 regular season games a week.
Rice check on Favre.
So stock up on all your favorites.
Hey, Brett.
Hey, John.
NFL Sunday Ticket. It's not on cable. See it on DirecTV. So what are you looking at?
The more you do something, the better you get. State Farm's been settling car insurance claims for over 75 years, millions of them. We've come up with a system that works so well that more drivers trust State Farm than all those cut-rate insurers put together. You're buying into that promise that we're going to be there to take care of you when the claim happens. Every day, State Farm handles over 30,000 claims. It's a practice makes perfect thing. That's the reason the competition doesn't stand a chance.
And like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
Nine programs, $27.
No batting.
Five hot dogs, six pennants, $45. One big puffy hand, $6. Their first big league ball game, priceless. There are some things money can't buy. For everything else, there's MasterCard, the card at the heart of Major League Baseball.
It's the most hair-raising Halloween special ever.
I'll show you hair.
An all-new Simpsons, part of a full hour. Fox Sunday at 7:30, 6:30 Central.
David Cone heads back to the hill. Bottom of the third inning, no score, no hits. Each side has a walk. Here are David Cone's thoughts on the Yankees' standing in this series so far.
Certainly, we feel good about it, but we only go back 2 years and remember when we were down 0-2 going into Atlanta, and we know what that feels like. We know that every World Series game can swing the momentum the other way. We know it's going to be a wild football crowd here in San Diego, and you know, this thing's a long way from over.
And you will hear that sentiment echoed really throughout the Yankee team. Talked about it during game two, that Joe Torre at no point feared that his team would ever become lazy with the kind of lead that they had in the American League East. They ended up winning the division over Boston, which won the wild card with the second best record in the American League. They won the division by 22 games and really never were challenged in those quote unquote big games throughout the 1998 regular season. Joe Torre didn't worry about it, and you can bet that the Yankees aren't going to relax up 2-0. That's been their season since it began the final day of March.
Joe Torre, fond of quoting the great golfer Bobby Jones, saying that his team plays against par. That's what keeps them going.
Sidearm delivery from Cone, and the count 1-2 on Chris Gomez.
Sidearm breaking ball from David Cone tries to get Chris Gomez to chase right out of the strike zone. He's able to hold up.
And now the 1-2. Strike three called over the outside corner. Back-to-back strikeouts for Cone. Going back to the second and three. Strikeouts here in game three for the Yankee right-hander.
Same breaking ball, but a little better location this time. Just changed his release point, his line of sight, able to hit Joe Girardi's glove right on the outside corner.
A strike in at the knees to Sterling Hitchcock, who in this postseason is 1-for-7. During the regular season, 7 out of 50 with just 2 RBIs, but he's put the bat on the ball. His one hit was an important one in game three of the NLCS here against Atlanta. And if you remember, he hit that little flare into left field that was botched by Danny Bautista in game six of the NLCS to score a couple of big runs and lead to another. Easy for Jeter, 2 up, 2 down for the Padres in the third. Well, we told you about the 20-plus gallons of paint have been spread on this field, and George Steinbrenner walking the field before the game and then meeting up with Joe Torre. It has been confirmed that he said the field was in the worst condition he has ever seen.
And so far, that was the most noise we've heard in Qualcomm Stadium when George Steinbrenner walked out on the field during the Yankees batting practice. Really got a reaction from the fans. And it wasn't a positive reaction. Let's just put it that way.
A strike to Kilvio Varas. They always say this game isn't played on paper. Well, tonight it's being played on paint. You see the grounds crew guy showing up at the local hardware store? Like 20 gallons of your greenish paint. Just to make it look more presentable. But these infielders, and heck, the outfielders will tell you before the end of the night, the paint might look nice, but it doesn't improve the condition of this field. Strike two on Kilvio Varas.
Well, Qualcomm Stadium has always been one of the faster natural grass fields in all of baseball when in the best condition. The players will tell you it plays very much like AstroTurf. The ball gets in the gaps, rolls to the wall very quickly. It gets on the infielders very quickly.
A ball and two strikes on Varas. Breaking ball low. 2-2. What kind of a hop do you typically get off paint? A book on that?
It depends on whether it's oil based or water based.
Two pitches chopped up the middle for Knobloch. Gets the true hop. Throws out Varas. The Padres go in order. We sail through 3 innings. Game three, no score.
These days, everything's faster. Everything. So how come pain relief isn't faster? Introducing Advil Liqui Gels. On tough pain, they're stronger and faster than extra strength Tylenol. New Advil Liqui Gels. Stronger and faster.
You look awful. Sinus pressure, huh? You know how Advil handles your tough pain fast? Well, Advil Cold and Sinus handles tough sinus pain fast. This is in this, plus a decongestant. That's why they call it Advil Cold and Sinus.
Trust. We are not born with an instinct to trust. Trust must be earned. Trust must be proven. We earn it with integrity. We prove it with sound advice. Trust is the ultimate measure of our success. And that is why we measure success one investor at a time.
He picked up his bat. Enterprise Rent-A-Car salutes Mark McGuire for picking us all up. Pick Enterprise. We'll pick you up.
Prodigy Internet has fast email. So, you spend less time online and more time on life. Prodigy Internet.
I miss San Diego Chicken. He was a happy chicken. He would come out and wiggle and dance, and I would laugh and laugh. I miss him.
King of the Hill returns next Tuesday, now for a full hour, starting at 8, 7 Central.
Wish granted. Very basic sign. To the point, very honest, and it worked. And hello to Uncle Greg. We go to the fourth inning. There is no score. And Sterling Hitchcock brings it to Nabla. By the way, I don't have an Uncle Greg. That's what the sign said. Ball one to Nabla. Nabla 0 for 1. Think back to the first inning. If you were with us, that was the ball that Finley bobbled in center and eventually hung on to. Juggling act for the first out. One ball, one strike on Knobloch here. Hitchcock on 1-1 to Knobloch. Off the end of the bat into center for Finley. Knobloch 0 for 2. John Travolta checking out game 3 of the 1998 World Series.
Little Tuesday night fever here at Qualcomm.
Derek Jeter walks to the plate. Jeter walked his first time, then was involved in the double play hit into by Paul O'Neill. Blair in by Hitchcock. As Jeter tests Gomez, it's through him and into left field in the first Yankee hit of the night.
And remember that graphic that we showed you earlier. First time through the order. His fourth start, they're now 0 for 31. But with that hit by Jeter, 8 for 26 the second time through the order. That's not uncommon with most pitchers, by the way. They're more successful early, first time, because the hitters haven't seen them. And you get more or less used to the rhythm of the pitcher, the speed of the pitches, where his splitters are breaking, curveballs reacting.
Now 1-on-1 out for Paul O'Neill as the Yankees try to get something started in the fourth inning with no score. Ball to O'Neill.
One thing that Sterling Hitchcock has working in his favor right now, he has showed very few breaking balls up to this point of the ball game. Basically going with fastballs that will sink away from righties, cut fastballs that will move in on the righties, and that split finger. He's thrown very few curveballs, which is a very good pitch for him.
The Yankees, by the way, did not go out of their way to get the left-handed hitters out of their lineup. Check on Jeter. Bobby Cox, on the other hand, against Sterling Hitchcock. In the two starts that Hitchcock made against Atlanta, used his right-handed hitting lineup. Joe Torre sticks with, for good reason, Paul O'Neill and Tino Martinez. Two guys who usually face left-handed pitching anyway. And the other aspect to it is Hitchcock might be more dangerous against right-handed hitters. One ball, one strike.
The Yankees, for the most part, undeterred by left-handers. They were 33-11 this year against left-handed pitching.
Dave Stewart was quoted after the divisional play and then the NLCS talking about the opposition loading up right-handed bats against Sterling Hitchcock. He said, big mistake. Brian Cashman, the Yankee general manager. One on, one out. One ball, one strike. Strike two.
I don't think there's any question that Sterling Hitchcock's best pitch is that split-fingered fastball, and many left-handed pitchers hesitate to throw that pitch to left-handed hitters. They'll go more to the traditional breaking balls, and in Hitchcock's case, that is not his first or second best pitch. He's going to his third best pitch if he throws breaking balls to lefties.
A ball and two strikes on O'Neill. One on, one out, no score, fourth inning. Two gone. Strikeout number three for Sterling Hitchcock. A high fastball, and O'Neill will have a seat. The Aflac trivia question. Three players have won the World Series MVP award twice. Can you name them? I know you know one of them, Mr. McCarver.
Yes, I do.
Here's Bernie Williams, one on, two out.
I actually think I know one of them this time. What if it's the same one? Then we have to guess the other one.
Williams is 1-for-9 in this World Series. The one was the two-run home run in game two. Jeter has drawn a couple of looks over at first base from Hitchcock. During the regular season, Jeter stole 30, was caught six times. This postseason, he has stolen three and has not been caught. Ball one to Bernie Williams.
That was a terrific pitch to Paul O'Neill. Paul O'Neill, very adept at taking that ball the other way, particularly with two strikes. And you mentioned Dave Stewart, the terrific pitching coach of the Padres, saying that one of the things that the Padre pitchers have not done is come inside, and that's where Hitchcock threw that last fastball. Neck high and inside off the plate to O'Neill.
2-0 to Bernie Williams.
Dave Stewart said through the first two games he didn't see any of the Yankees hitters jackknifed at the plate. It's that up and in fastball to force them to respect the inside part of the plate and not reach out there and hit those good pitches on the outside corner. That guy had no problems jackknifing hitters.
No.
Two balls, no strikes. Bernie Williams was ahead in the count in his first at bat. Eventually struck out looking. The ground ball up the middle. Gomez. Big time range to his left. And the flip for Veras. The force out 6-4. We go to the bottom of the fourth. Gwynn, Vaughn, Caminiti coming up. No score.
Are you concerned about losing more hair? Do you wonder how much further it will go? Do you wish you could do something about it? Well, now there's a pill for men with certain types of hair loss. Introducing Propecia. In clinical studies, the vast majority of men, 83%, maintain their current hair count, and most, 66%, regrew some hair. Take it daily and you could see results in as little as 3 months. Propecia is for men only. A small number of men experience certain sexual side effects. Each occurred in less than 2% of men. Women who are or may potentially be pregnant must not use it or handle broken tablets because of the risk of a specific kind of birth defect. Talk to your doctor or pharmacist and read the consumer information they can provide. Propecia, helping make hair loss history.
Before you do this or this or this, you want to have this and this and this.
You'd be surprised how much of our technology goes into your day.
So for this, 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 or this, or this.
We're Siemens.
We can do that.
Chevy Silverado, the Motor Trend Truck of the Year. It's bigger, it's more powerful, it's the truck from Chevrolet.
All right, bring it in here, guys. Huddle up. Now listen up, fellas. We got a full house out there. They can't get to the Rockies, so let's bring the Rockies to them.
All right.
We got the coldest beer around. With frost brewed Coors Light in our trays, there's no reason we shouldn't have a great day. Right. Now, what do they want?
Coors Light.
What do we got?
Coors Light.
What?
Coors Light.
I can't hear you.
Coors Light.
Get ready.
Imagine making a deal with the devil to get to heaven.
It's burning in hell.
Peter Horton in Brimstone, premiering Friday at 8, 7 Central on Fox.
Chris Gomez, when he was 5 years old, his mother used to roll him balls. And when he'd miss it, he'd have to go chase it, obviously. He figured that the best thing to do was to catch it because he didn't have good speed. Well, Mom, you did a good job. That was our super shot there. Fine play by Gomez to end the Yankee fourth.
2-3 and four hitters for San Diego. Gwynn, Vaughn, and Caminiti, no score. Bottom of the fourth inning, game number three. One ball, one strike from David Cone. These should be good battles as long as they last. Cone against Tony Gwynn. Guy who does nothing but think on the mound against one of the game's most accomplished hitters as Gwynn pops it into center. Bernie Williams doesn't see it but has time to recover, one away. We gave you our Aflac trivia question. Three players have won the World Series MVP award twice. Can you name them? Our Aflac trivia answer, one of them, Tim McCarver used to catch, Bob Gibson in 1964 and 67, Sandy Koufax in 63 and 65, and Reggie Jackson, 1973 and 1977.
How about that? Reggie Jackson, the only one with two different teams.
Bernie having a hard time finding the ball in the twilight here in San Diego, but stays with it. Both his right fielder, left fielder, and second baseman were streaking to the spot to help him out.
Strike one. Greg Vaughn lined out to first, a soft liner caught by Tino Martinez back in the first. He pounded two home runs in game number one. And he rips this one into left. Spencer. Two gone.
Well, during Ken Caminiti's first at bat, we're going to get a look at the pitch placement as David Cone goes after Ken Caminiti. You see his hot zone. First pitch is a splitter down out of the zone, then a hanging splitter for a strike. He pulled that pitch foul to go to two strikes, and then the Laredo slider in the red zone, but Caminiti not anticipating that backdoor breaking ball.
And with two out, nothing working for the Padres here in the fourth inning. Here is Caminiti with that strikeout to his credit so far. Ball one. Caminiti hit 29 home runs during the regular season. One ball, one strike. It'll be real interesting to see Caminiti try to run if he's put in a position where he has to really burn it down to first or in an extra base situation. That strained groin. How well he can move. One ball, one strike. And now 2-1.
Is it early enough in the game for us to talk about the fact that David Cone has a no-hitter going, or should we? When do we stop talking about the fact that David Cone has a no-hitter going? Like the fifth or sixth or something?
You're talking about jinx time.
Yeah.
You can only talk about it for so long, and then there's a period of time where you can't bring it up at all. But you're more veteran announcer in this type of situation.
Yeah, but you're our leader. You got to give us signals.
Two out, nobody on, three balls and a strike. David Cone hasn't given up a hit, but he has given up two walks. That's his second, and it keeps the fourth inning alive for San Diego. Here's Wally Joyner.
I always find it interesting to watch how a veteran pitcher goes after hitters from at bat to at bat. During Wally Joyner's first at bat in this game, David Cone fed him a steady diet of four-seam fastballs.
And the fastball up and away for ball one. Wally Joyner has the other walk. Caminiti is on base. 2-0.
Against most pitchers, again, on a 2-0 count, with the runner being held at first base, most left-handed hitters would look for that fastball to jerk. But remember, Cone is unorthodox.
A strike on the outside corner. Let me ask you this. With the groin injury, part of Ken Caminiti, is it worth it to hold against him with a left-handed batter, Joyner up and two outs here in the inning?
I think against a different left-handed hitter, you may see the Yankees play Tino Martinez behind Caminiti at first, but Joyner is not really a pull hitter. He hits the ball from gap to gap. Occasionally, he'll pull an off-speed pitch.
Three and one to Joyner. Game two. Those last couple of cuts by Caminiti. This is not a replay. He had two swings in succession as Joyner pops it up left side. Caminiti getting down to second as Brocious in foul territory takes care of Joyner, who's retired for the first time tonight. The Padres have stranded two. We've played four. Martinez will lead off the fifth for New York. No score.
The PC world was stuck in flat zone. Everything was crushed into a flat, dull format.
Get her.
All we ever wanted was a 3D life. But no one escaped the 2D PC police. Until now.
The AMD K62 processor with 3D Now technology. Suddenly, the world inside your PC is no longer flat.
Cigarettes and nicotine clearly do not meet the classic definitions of addiction.
Nicotine is not addictive.
Nicotine is not addictive.
I have found you can't trust anything the tobacco industry says. Now they're spending millions on ads attacking Proposition 10, a 50-cent per pack cigarette tax that will help our kids and fight smoking. California's doctors, nurses, and teachers don't believe the tobacco industry, and neither should you.
50 cents a pack for our kids. Vote yes on Proposition 10.
You read Barron's?
Oh, yeah. All the time. That's the one where they rate all the online brokers. I use Discover Brokerage. They've been Barron's top pick for, like, the last 3 years.
You invest online?
Oh, yeah. Big time. Well, the last few years, anyway. I'm retired now.
You're retired?
Oh, I don't need to do this. I just, you know, like helping people.
Vacation spot?
Actually, it's a picture of my house.
That's an island.
Well, technically, it's a country. Weird thing about owning your own country, though. You gotta name it.
Turn for the best sports news? With 3,500 pro games a year, we are your news source. Fox Sports News, better because we are there.
This is a worthwhile look at the pitch count of Sterling Hitchcock through four innings. Game three of the LCS, game six. Now tonight, only 50 pitches through four innings. He has economized very, very well. Only one hit by the Yankees.
One hit, one walk. Tino Martinez. As we move to the top of the fifth inning, along with producer John Filippelli, director Bill Webb, Joe Buck, Bob Brenly, Tim McCarver. Only one hit tonight. It belongs to Derek Jeter. Tino Martinez takes it just outside, one ball, one strike. You're looking at a pitcher in Sterling Hitchcock that the Yankees didn't think had any heart. 1992 to 1995. He got his opportunity with the Yankees as Martinez hits the comebacker. Hitchcock gets the out. And if you remember back to the NLCS this year, after Kevin Brown pitched in this stadium in Game 5, Sterling Hitchcock immediately went to Dave Stewart and Bruce Bochy and said, give me the ball for Game 6, I'm ready. And what did he do? He went out and won the clincher against the Braves in Atlanta.
It got to the point in New York, Joe, where the owner, George Steinbrenner, actually called Sterling Hitchcock the fat boy. And obviously not a sign of respect, but Dave Stewart has worked long and hard with Sterling Hitchcock to develop that demeanor out there on the mound where, as you said, he wants the ball in crucial situations now.
So pitching against the New York Yankees, Sterling Hitchcock, with his Padres down 2-0, has allowed no runs on one hit, and he's 0-2 on Scott Brosius.
And experience teaches you in the game of baseball not to give tags like that at a young age. Maybe if a guy's 35 and his career's almost finished, then a tag like that might be worthwhile. But when you say a 23, 24-year-old pitcher doesn't have a heart, you better know it. And I think he's proven whoever said that and whoever hung it on him wrong.
Brosius lines a drive into left center field. Over to cut it off is Vaughn, moving around pretty well in left field. And Scott Brosius has the Yankees' second hit of the night. Well, tomorrow it's Game 4, and we'll be right back here as the Yankees and Padres continue to battle for the World Championship. It's Game 4 of the World Series tomorrow night, 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, only on Fox. And as we talked about at the top, while the Yankees will have a fresh Andy Pettit scheduled to go in Game 4, the Padres are hoping and leaning toward using Kevin Brown. One on, one out. Shane Spencer takes the ball low.
You would think that if the Padres are down 3-0 tomorrow night, you have to use Kevin Brown. If they're down 2-1, you should use Kevin Brown. Bruce Bochy unsure right now.
One ball, no strikes, one on, one out. 1-1.
I agree with you, Tim. I mean, if they're down 3-0, obviously you have to start your best pitcher in Game 4 in order just to try to continue the series. Should the Padres win tonight, you start Kevin Brown tomorrow. Conceivably, should the Padres be able to run it to Game 7, you could have Brown available to pitch Game 7.
If you hold him off for Game 5, then you don't have him available in a Game 7 situation if you get there.
Unless it's in relief.
They almost picked off Brosius. He was wandering, and Hitchcock, with a better throw, might have had him.
Brosius just completely fooled by that move. Didn't appear to be running, just kind of wandering off there, getting his secondary lead, and realizes very late that Hitchcock was coming over to first base.
He's at first with one out, one ball, one strike on Shane Spencer. Two.
Shane Spencer burst upon the scene this year, just wearing out fastballs. Every fastball he saw, he hit out of the ballpark. Team started to go after him with big curveballs. He eventually made an adjustment, started hitting the curveball. But the Cleveland Indians fed him a steady diet of changeups, split fingers, off-speed pitches with good arm movement. Spencer has yet to figure out that pitch.
One in the dirt to make it 2-2. Shane Spencer in the division series against the Texas Rangers, Game 2. His first in the postseason at Yankee Stadium over the 399 mark in left center field. And then in the clincher, Game 3, he pounded the home run, made the score 4-0, and the Yankees rolled right through the Texas Rangers, allowing only one run along the way. To get to the ALCS, a look at Ricky Lede, who's had two strong games in this World Series. Sitting this one out as Spencer keeps it 2-2.
A high leg kick from Spencer. That appeared to be a split finger that just didn't split, stayed up in the zone. had a pretty good hack at it. Many times as a hitter, if you see a mistake pitch, a hanging breaking ball or a split that doesn't do anything and you foul it off, that's more frustrating than swinging and missing or taking the pitch for a strike.
One on, one out, two balls, two strikes. And that's foul.
Against major league pitching, you tell yourself, I'm going to take advantage of mistakes. If he makes a mistake, I'm going to be ready and hit it. And then you get that mistake pitch and foul it off. That can be very aggravating.
Most of your good split finger fastballs, and this was one, out of the strike zone. Big difference between that one and the ball he fouled back. Poor swing at that splitter.
The count still 2-2, one on, one out. No score in the fifth. Inside corner, struck him out. Got him with a fastball. And strikeout number 4 for Hitchcock.
That 90-mile-an-hour fastball looks about 100 miles an hour when you have been fed a steady diet of splitters. Fastball on the corner. Pack the bags, light the lights. Curves are coming left and right.
So one on, two out. Working with Nipsey Russell all of a sudden. Girardi down the left field line, hooking foul into the Padres bullpen.
We talked about the speed of the grass here at Qualcomm Stadium. Another unique feature is that area in the bullpens. Down the left and right field line where Girardi just hit that foul ball. Many times a hitter will pull a ball inside the line. It will roll into foul territory and end up ricocheting around in that bullpen. And occasionally a fielder will actually have to throw the ball over the stands to get it back into the infield.
And occasionally there's more than one ball rolling around down in there. I mean, you said the other night, bullpens are not the most well-kept areas on a baseball diamond, and you don't know what's laying around down there.
And how right you were, too, Bob.
You see jackets and duffel bags and towels and paper cups laying around. Tough to find a ball in there sometimes.
The 0-1 pitch, Girardi takes it low, a ball and a strike.
You can imagine right now what's going through third base coach Willie Randolph's mind. On a ball hit down the line or any kind of gapper, he's going to try to score Scott Brosius because David Cone is on deck and there are two outs. Outfield in this situation plays a step or two deeper to try to cut off the extra base hit with the pitcher coming up next.
That nasty splitter for strike two. There's a guy who featured a pretty nasty splitter, and he brought that pitch to this San Diego pitching staff.
See that tumbling movement? The ball just dives toward the ground. Looks like a strike about 90% of the way to home plate, and then suddenly it's out of the strike zone.
Hitchcock through five.
Ask 100 brewers and they'll tell you the same thing. Great water helps make the most refreshing beer. So do you think all brewers use the same ice cold water? Think again.
Volvos have always forced other cars to be safer. This one will force them to be better. The new Volvo S80.
They've had to do a little remodeling at Pizza Hut headquarters since their co-founder came out of retirement to become a Papa John's franchisee. See, he thinks Papa John's makes better pizza than even the company he helped found. Today, Frank owns over 70 restaurants.
Papa John's. Better ingredients, better pizza.
He's got it.
Papa John's.
Hey, looks good here.
Try our Papa's Choice. That's a large pizza with your choice of up to 5 toppings for just $9.99.
Your investments help pay for this dream house.
Unfortunately, it belongs to your broker. With the new E-Trade, the power is in your hands. The number one rated place to invest online. Now open free to the public with 10 times more research. Free real-time quotes, still from just $14.95 a trade. Sign up now and get $50 free. Hey, now the power's in your hands. E-Trade, someday we'll all invest this way.
Safer than any car we've ever built. As thrilling as any car anyone's ever built. The new Volvo S80.
The 1998 World Series is brought to you by E-Trade, the number one rated place to invest online. And by Nasonex.
One of the world's most enduring symbols, the Goodyear Blimp Eagle, has been providing these aerial pictures all night long. For a look inside the Goodyear Blimp and how it maneuvers, try its website at www.goodyear.com. San Diego will bat in the bottom of the fifth inning. There is no score. Finley, Lehrich, and Gomez coming up against David Cone, who has yet to allow a hit. The Padres in this series have now seen three starters for the Yankees who are more than willing, seemingly in any situation, to change their arm angle. We saw it with Wells in game one. We saw it just about all night with El Duque in game two. And David Cone, one of the first to bring that to this group with the Yankees. One ball, one strike on Finley.
The difference with David Cone, when you compare him to David Wells or Orlando Hernandez, is that Cone will do it to left-handed batters. Wells, a left-handed pitcher, does it to left-handers. Hernandez,
that's foul,
for the most part, does it to right-handed batters, but Cone will do it to right and left-handed batters. We have seen him drop down and get a strike three and to Ken Caminiti in the second inning.
Andy Pettit was in your picture there. He is one who doesn't change the arm angle.
No.
He is scheduled to pitch game four as Finley took one just out of the zone. Two balls, two strikes.
I think it's strange to see the arm angles, the change in arm angles that you're talking about on three effective pitchers. Generally, that's something a pitcher does towards the end of his career to try to trick hitters.
Finley was almost tricked right there, and he stays alive.
I mean, the guys we're talking about are all right on top of their game, and they're incorporating that as part of their repertoire to change the look of their pitches. Fastball right in on the hands, ties up Steve Finley, tried to pull the bat in a little bit, barely able to get a piece of it.
The 2-2. Full count to Finley leading off the fifth.
Tried to come in the side door and the 2-2 pitch missed, but even throwing a no-hitter through four.
One away as Cone comes up with strikeout number four.
David Cone with a lot of deep counts. The 3-2 pitch, and what does he throw but the splitter? You just cannot guess with this guy.
As a hitter, you have to be prepared to protect the plate. You see the arm motion, you assume it's a fastball. And much like Sterling Hitchcock from the other side of the rubber, that split finger just dies as it gets into the hitting zone.
Look at Mel Stottlemyre, the pitching coach for the Yankees on your right. David Cone, his 62nd pitch of the night, was strike number three to Finley as Lehrich falls behind early. Lehrich 0-for-1 tonight, 0-for-6 in this World Series. One ball, one strike.
I do not think David Cone and Joe Girardi will come inside to Lehrich unless it's a bad fastball right around the letters. Everything else will be away, one would assume.
Sound like he broke his bat. Pop up to the right side for Knobloch. Staggers a bit. Two down. Two up, two down here in the bottom of the fifth inning for San Diego. We'll give you a look at our game summary brought to you by MCI. And what else can we tell you other than David Cone, through 4 2/3 innings, he's allowed no hits. He's walked two, struck out four. And Sterling Hitchcock against his former team, five innings, no runs on two hits with five strikeouts and one walk.
Yeah, the only guys that have been busy in this game are the two pitchers and the bat boys, putting the bats back in the rack.
Ball one up and in to Chris Gomez, the number eight hitter with two out. Nobody on, and the pitcher Hitchcock on deck. One ball, one strike as Cone hits the outside corner.
They usually change bases in the middle of the game. They won't have to change third base. It's perfectly clean because nobody's been there. Look at that. Spotless.
Gomez loops one into right. Paul O'Neill. The running catch in toward the infield, and we go to the sixth inning. Already in game three, Yankees up 2-0. There is no score.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Fortunately, there's Nasonex nasal spray. An effective nasal allergy prescription medicine taken once a day that relieves sneezing, itchy runny nose, and congestion, indoors and out. Now that's wonderful. Nasonex, what good days are like every day. The most common side effects were headache, viral infection, sore throat, nosebleeds, and coughing.
Dandruff, psoriasis, scalp dermatitis. If you asked all the dermatologists listed here to recommend a therapeutic shampoo, Neutrogena T-Gel would come out number one. T-Gel works on all three itchy, flaky scalp conditions. Neutrogena T-Gel, it works.
Nine programs, $27.
Now batting.
Five hot dogs, six pennants, $45. One big puffy hand, $6. Their first big league ball game? Priceless. There are some things money can't buy. For everything else, there's MasterCard, the card at the heart of Major League Baseball.
My cousin Al still swears he never gets enough to eat. So tonight we took him back to the Olive Garden for more of their never-ending pasta bowl.
It's any special pasta you like,
with all the free refills you want, plus all the salad and breadsticks for $6.95. The Olive Garden. When you're here, you're family.
I want to hear everything they're afraid to show us in school.
From the director of The Usual Suspects comes the movie Newsweek calls, an ambitious investigation into the nature of evil.
Stop it!
Act Pupil.
He wanted to know everything.
Rated R. Opens Friday.
The X-Files. The new season begins November 8th on Fox.
The truth is out there. So is one of the stars of the X-Files, Gillian Anderson, here enjoying tonight's World Series Game 3. You can catch her in the much-anticipated new season when the X-Files returns with all new episodes Sunday night, November 8th, only here on Fox. Your cover is blown, Agent Scully. Got the hat pulled down low. Anybody watching in the ballpark now knows that Gillian Anderson is here and watching Game 3. David Cone takes a strike over the outside corner. As each team is at the same spot in their lineup here in the sixth inning. The pitcher leads off in the top half. Pitcher's spot will lead off in the bottom half. One ball, one strike. From Hitchcock to David Cone. Cone lines one into left field for a base hit. David Cone, who in his career had 61 base hits, gets his first of this season. And I say this season because of interleague play, and it comes leading off the sixth inning.
Fastball up and out over the plate. That's what you're supposed to do with it if you're a hitter. From catcher cam, you'll get a look at the location of this pitch. Hard of the plate, up around the belt. Well, he looked like a hitter on that pitch.
Sure did.
Interesting situation. Now, do you bunt? David Cone is not only a pitcher, but almost no base running experience. Last time he hit in a game and ran the bases was in this ballpark back in 1993.
He's at first with nobody out. Draws a throw.
They check on him right away, hoping to catch him leaning the wrong way. Perhaps checking for signs while Hitchcock throws to first.
course, David did hit in the World Series in 1996, talking regular season game. But not a good base runner.
And not a big lead as Knobloch does bunt, drops down a beauty. Caminiti, the barehanded pickup, the high throw, and the first two Yankees are on here in the sixth inning. Back-to-back hits by Cone and Knobloch.
So you don't sacrifice, you try to bunt for a base hit as Knobloch does. Caminiti plays back, and because he didn't square around, he had to stay back, forced into a barehanded pickup, and he throws it wild. I think that will be a base hit.
Get a look from Super Shot as Caminiti barehands this ball. I think perhaps that groin bothered him, very deliberate as he charged that ball. Normally a very aggressive fielding third baseman, but was a little tentative as he got close to that ball and had to bend down and make that barehanded play.
It is ruled a base hit. It's David Cone. Lined one the opposite way for a leadoff single. Chuck Knobloch gets the bunt base hit. And now with two on and nobody out, and Derek Jeter coming to the plate, not only a visit from Dave Stewart to his pitcher Sterling Hitchcock, but a little meeting on the mound amongst the infielders with his two on nobody out situation.
Bob, you brought up a great point in that Atlanta series when Kevin Brown was the runner at second base down in Atlanta in game two and nobody was out. And you brought up the fact that if a hitter bunts through the ball in a situation like this, a pitcher has a very difficult time determining whether to break for third or not. Their instincts are just not as good, obviously, as everyday players.
And keep in mind, Javi Lopez was a catcher for the Braves, a man with a strong throwing arm that liked to throw to second base. We'll see if Leyritz is as aggressive if there is a bunt situation and Jeter misses the ball.
Two on with nobody out. And a look back towards second. Corners of the Padre infield creeping in. Joiner at first and Caminiti at third.
Puts a lot of pressure on the infielders, especially the corners, because Jeter is such a good hitter. You can't be guaranteed that he's going to bunt the ball here.
Two on with nobody out for the Yankees. The ball low. No signs of the bunt from Jeter there as he took ball one from Sterling Hitchcock. And a perfect opportunity for the Yankees, up two games to none, with two on, nobody out, Jeter, O'Neill, and Williams coming up. Already 1-0 on Derek Jeter. One ball, one strike.
Well, in the event of a base hit to the outfield, here's a scouting report on the Padres outfielders. Greg Vaughn, a below average arm. We know he's been hampered by that sore leg. Finley, the best arm by far in the Padres outfield. And Tony Gwynn, very accurate and gets himself in good position to make a strong throw.
Yeah, and on a base hit right to an outfielder in this situation, no way Willie Randolph tries to score David Cone, not with nobody out.
The 1-1 to Jeter, high, two balls and a strike, and no signs of the bunt from Jeter on any pitch from Hitchcock.
I think Joe Torre would put the bunt on if anybody else but David Cone were on at second base.
Two balls and a strike. 3-1 on Derek Jeter. Already action for the Padres in their bullpen now as Sterling Hitchcock has hit his first bump here in game three. Joey Hamilton getting ready as the 3-1 pitch is brought to Jeter. Full count. And the Yankees have played it straight. Trying to put New York out in front. One away. big strikeout for Hitchcock.
And again, that's why you don't send the runners in that situation, because your pitcher is your lead runner. Looked like a fastball, a low heater. You don't see Jeter swinging through that pitch that often, but that was a big, big strikeout for Hitchcock.
See a pitch down around the knees? Yeah, having David Cone as the lead runner in this situation has really changed the entire outlook of this inning and what Joe Torre is able to do.
Yep.
Now two on, one out for O'Neill. Strike one. You've got Paul O'Neill up now. The switch hitting Williams on deck. Anybody after that, Tino Martinez, another left-handed batter. So the big strikeout for Hitchcock. He would figure to stay in now for the next three hitters, including O'Neill. Two on, one out. The middle through. They will bring Cone to the plate and now hold him late. Cone put on the brakes, and Finley with that good strong arm throws it on the fly to the plate, and the bases are loaded with one out for the Yankees.
Yeah, there is no way you could try to score David Cone on that play. Willie Randolph was bringing him around third. And that's in case Finley bobbles the ball momentarily. He'll be in a position to score. But David would have been out by 10 feet.
The Padres may have been able to steal an out at second base had Wally Joyner been in the cut position early enough. Chuck Knobloch was watching the runner ahead of him, took a very aggressive turnaround second, and was out in no man's land. Joyner was late getting to his cut position. There was nobody there to cut the ball off and make the play at second base.
Yankees thought they had something. They get the hit from O'Neill, but it loads the bases with only one out for Bernie Williams. A high fastball, strike one. It's now Bernie Williams' chance to put New York out in front here in the sixth inning. Again, Williams up now, and the left-handed hitting Tino Martinez on deck. Strike two.
Swinging at the first pitch out of the strike zone. Back inside. Strike two. And now the splitter gets him.
Now the left-handed hitting Tino Martinez. Again at the plate with the bases loaded. Third time in this World Series already he's been in this position. He's come through for the Yankees once. Strike one. And again, we tell you, no player has ever hit two grand slams in World Series play. Martinez got one in game one. Still no score.
A Major League Baseball season to remember. Sponsored by American General Financial Group. Live the life you've imagined.
Teamwork made 98 a season to remember, and the Yankees are a great example.
Got him!
what a play.
There's no secret to their success. Just hard work, camaraderie, and sacrifice. And they set an American League record with 114 victories in a season.
And the Yankees get the win.
Men and women who can help you with retirement plans, life insurance, and consumer loans. American General Financial Group. Helping over 12 million people live the life they've imagined. Live the life you've imagined.
He picked up his bat. Enterprise Rent-A-Car salutes Mark McGuire for picking us all up. Pick Enterprise. We'll pick you up.
The 1998 World Series is brought to you by Frost Brewed Coors Light, who reminds you the three most important words are, hey, beer man, and by Propecia. Talk to your doctor today.
Folks, we remind you, watch for the Gillette Mach 3 Strike Zone Challenge prior to Game 4 tomorrow night, the 1998 World Series, where you will see one lucky fan get the chance to throw a pitch for $2 million. Gillette will donate $1 million to the Susan G. Komen Breast Cancer Foundation. In addition to $1 million, Gillette will pay the Strike Zone Challenge winner. Sterling Hitchcock, a big hand as he leads off the bottom of the sixth inning. In the top of the sixth inning, it was good news, bad news for the Yankees. The good news, David Cone got a base hit. The bad news, David Cone got a base hit to lead off the inning. It changes the way it was played. And now Hitchcock returns the favor. Sterling Hitchcock with a leadoff base hit to start the bottom of the sixth. And the first hit for the Padres tonight belongs to Sterling Hitchcock, who gets his second of this postseason.
He looks like a hitter too. Both these left-handed swinging pitchers going up there and putting a nice stroke on the ball.
Now the Padres are confronted with the same thing that the Yankees were confronted with. Do you bunt over an inferior runner with his jacket on?
Ferris, no signs of the bunt. Ball one. Kilby Alvarez has bounced out twice, once to short, once to second. Now what will Bruce Bochy do? With a leadoff base hit, Varas takes a strike on a perfect pitch over the outside corner from David Cone.
Well, pitcher or no pitcher, Sterling Hitchcock needs to work for a little bit better lead over there at first base. Get a look at that last pitch to Kilby Alvarez. Nice job by Joe Girardi framing it. I mean, he could fall down and be on the base from that position.
Bunt is shown and taken back on ball two.
Third base coach Tim Flannery running through the signs for Sterling Hitchcock and Kilby Alvarez.
Brocious now in at third. A 2-2 count. Alvarez showed the bunt once. Back to the swing, and it's 2-2.
Showed the bunt to get into a favorable count. Got his fastball, but fouled it back.
No score in the bottom of the sixth inning here in game three. Hitchcock at first with nobody out. Varas took it just low. Three balls, two strikes.
You have a contact hitter at the plate and a pitcher on base. Normally, no question, you send them.
I think you got to send him anyway.
Not going as Veras takes ball four. And the first two Padres are on in the sixth.
Excuse me, didn't we just see this happening?
Deja vu all over again here.
Mel Stottlemyre on the phone to the bullpen. And who better for the Padres to have at the plate in this situation, even with Hitchcock the lead runner, than Tony Gwynn?
Well, I think the Padres, if they don't let Tony Gwynn just straight swing away, they'd be more likely to use a hit and run with Tony Gwynn than a bunt.
The problem with that is the pitchers don't know what the hit and run is, because they're rarely in a situation where you use them running. Seems to me like Bochy's going to play this straight up and just let Tony hack.
Two on, nobody out. And a ball from David Cohn.
There's a scouting report on Tony Gwynn. Can place that ball like he's shooting pool. He can wait on the ball so long, which is why he's very rarely fooled, and he's just as good a hitter with two strikes as he is on the first pitch of the count. Swung and missed at only 6% of his swings this year.
To the right side and through. They will bring Hitchcock to the plate. No throw by O'Neill. 1-0 San Diego. Now the throw gets away. It heads into the dugout. To the plate is Veras, and it's 2-0 Padres.
Throwing this ball.
I don't either.
In Little League, you teach your outfielders, when in doubt, throw it to the pitcher. That looks like what Paul O'Neill does right here. Misses the cutoff man. The ball goes directly over the mound between third and home and into the dugout on the third base side.
Looked to me like Paul O'Neill was totally disoriented when he came up with the ball. Tino Martinez was in place as the cutoff man, and now you got to play the Yankee infield in.
Went at third with nobody out, and Vaughn misses the RBI opportunity as Jeter. A wide throw, but Vaughn out easily, one away. That is a rare misplay by Paul O'Neill.
Rare and a huge play, as Veras is allowed to trot home, and Tony Gwynn goes all the way to third. Because this ball was hit down the line, Sterling Hitchcock was waved around by Tim Flannery. Yeah, that's close to being down the line, so O'Neill has to go to his left. And now the throw, inexplicable. I have no idea why Paul did that.
Now the infield in for Caminiti. Went at third with one away. Padres leading 2-0.
Tony Gwynn alive for the wild pitch. A lot of cone splitters are in the dirt.
Right-hander Mendoza, left-hander Loy getting ready for the Yankees in their bullpen. Into center field. Williams back at the track to make the catch. Tagging and scoring is Gwynn, and it's 3-0 San Diego.
Bernie Williams on his horse all the way to the warning track in straightaway center field. Get a look from Super Shot as he catches this ball right down toward the heel of the glove. Cradles it with that bare hand and is able to hang on, but Tony Gwynn walks home from third base.
Reaction by David Cohn.
So instead of two runs scoring in this inning, the O'Neill error has led to yet a third one.
And it's 3-0 San Diego in the sixth. Wally Joyner now with the bases empty. This for the Padres, by the way, is their first lead since the bottom of the seventh inning of game number one. Sterling Hitchcock not only getting out of trouble in the top of the inning, but starting trouble in the bottom of the sixth inning with a leadoff base hit.
You remember, Dave, Tony Gwynn's comment to Merv Rettman in the first inning when he hit that line drive to left field. David does not have any Getty up tonight. Tony Gwynn caught up with that non-Getty up.
Two balls, two strikes. Wally Joyner with the bases empty, two down, three runs in, one important error by O'Neill, who committed just four during the regular season, and if not spectacular, is one of the best defensive right fielders in baseball.
Fundamentally rock solid.
Joyner to the right side. Great play. Tino Martinez race to the bag, and it is won by David Cone. Padres lead by three after six. Back after this from your local Fox station.
This is John Beard. Tonight, winds grip up another brush fire. We'll take you live to San Bernardino for the look at the latest hotspot. That's tonight on Fox 11 News at 10.
Gray Davis has been misleading voters about Dan Lundgren's record.
In Congress, I voted for Head Start, school lunch programs, and to create student loans, but all within a balanced budget plan. I did vote against the federal bureaucracy so we could send more of our money directly to local schools. And as governor, I'll do the same thing. I'll take money from the bureaucracy, give it to local schools, and put parents and teachers back in charge. That's why I fought for charter schools and school vouchers, because competition will save our public schools. I will always fight to put kids first, not the bureaucracy.
If you were to take away all the luxury cars on this road, priced above $30,000, without such luxuries as Bose CD audio system, leather seats, and a satellite-linked navigation system, what you'd have left would be the new 225-horsepower Acura TL and one very empty road on which to enjoy it. The new TL from Acura.
Traffic sounds bad.
Yeah, so tell me about Cantex.
Just jump to 43 even, you're long 20,000.
What's the best way to sell that?
Checking the quote.
There's a huge size on the bid, no need to break it up.
You can move it as a block.
Good, sell it and market, okay?
Placing an order, moving 20,000.
I'm moving nowhere in Santa Monica.
Confirmed, 20,000 sold at market.
Can you give me the peonies?
Travel across the universe with Stargate SG-1, Saturday at 6 on Fox 11.
Paul O'Neill resting on the dugout bench after the throwing error, which led to an extra San Diego run. Here's what he did when he came in after the bottom of the sixth inning, talking to Chuck Knobloch about that throw that got away.
Yeah, perhaps he was trying to get the ball to Knobloch to hold Gwynn at first base. But the throw sailed over Knobloch, over the pitcher's mound, and into the third base dugout.
And Paul was caught in between and threw it between first and second.
Nothing and one, the count on Brocious leading off. One ball, one strike. Scott is 1-for-2 in this game and 5 out of 11 in the World Series. He leads the Yankees in the postseason with 10 RBIs. Hitchcock has got it working tonight. A ball and two strikes as he works here in the seventh inning.
And as this game has progressed, we've seen more and more of this pitch. The overhand curveball breaking down and in. Brocious swings right over the top.
The 1-2 from Hitchcock. Two balls, two strikes. Bottom of the order here for the Yankees, starting with the number six hitter. Cone is due up fourth in this inning. Anything starts to happen for the Yankees, you would imagine seeing a pinch hitter. Three balls, two strikes now on Brosius as he tries to get on to start the seventh inning with Spencer on deck and then Joe Girardi.
Now he's forced to throw the fastball. You have a three-run lead. You cannot allow Brosius to get on with a walk. Good hitting position for Scott Brosius. You know a fastball's coming.
True to form, and it's ripped into deep left center field. At the track, at the wall, it's gone. The 3-2 fastball, Brosius knew it, and he goes deep to make it a two-run game. It's 3-1. Well, you always hear it. That's preferable to a leadoff walk. Here hit it, and Brosius just knew what was coming and did his thing.
That home run didn't come on a 3-2 pitch. I mean, actually, it did. But what lost Scott Brosius was that 2-2 curveball. Catchers and pitchers are trained to throw the pitch that the pitcher gets over most on a 2-2 count, so you don't get in a position like this. You miss with a curve, now you've got to throw the fastball.
Brian Cashman, the general manager of the Yankees, with the thumbs up. Scott Brosius. This is Spencer. Joe Torre told us before game one, he said, we had absolutely no idea the kind of player we were getting when we picked up Scott Brosius. None. He hit 203 last year. Into left center field. That's well hit. Won't be caught. Takes a hop up against the wall. A homer, a double, and here come the Yankees in the seventh.
Yeah, Bruce Boch is going to make a trip to the mound. I think you have to do something to stem this momentum right now. As we've seen throughout the regular season and the postseason, the Yankees are very much a team that capitalizes on opportunities and has many big innings.
If we get a pitching change here, and we will, you're going to hear a heck of a reaction for Sterling Hitchcock.
You're going to get a hitting change, too.
Breaks loose.
Time to give the devil his due.
Brimstone premieres Friday at 8, 7 Central on Fox.
Top of the seventh inning, Joey Hamilton in the game now for the latest Fox Sports World Series coverage. Log on to www.foxsports.com, sponsored by Qualcomm. As Joey Hamilton steps out of the San Diego bullpen and will appear for the first time in this World Series.
Never know what's going to happen. I think this is a mistake on Bruce Bochy's part. To me, I would leave Hitchcock in the game and allow him to pitch to Girardi for several reasons, one of which it's easier for the left-handed batter to pull the ball and get the runner to third. And that's only one of them. You've got a much better matchup with Hitchcock against Girardi than Hamilton against Posada.
Jorge Posada, the pinch hitter, facing Hamilton. That gets away. Over to the third is Spencer. Great base running as he was on the move. The split second that ball got away from Leiritz. And it's now Spencer at third with nobody out.
Normally, Bruce Bochy will take Leiritz out in a situation like this. But Leiritz is up second in the bottom of the seventh inning, and he wants to get one more at bat out of it. That ball should have been handled.
Hamilton, a considerably harder thrower than Sterling Hitchcock. It looked like Leiritz was caught by surprise.
Now with Spencer at third and nobody out, one ball, one strike from Joey Hamilton, a starter during the regular season. Facing Jorge Posada, it's ruled a passed ball on the part of Leiritz to get Spencer to third, and now Posada, strike two.
One thing that perhaps entered into Bruce Bochy's decision to bring in the right-hander is the fact that Posada hits about 130 points higher against left-handed pitching. Considerably lower numbers against the right-handers.
Ball and two strikes on Jorge Posada. This time, Leiritz makes a nice play to keep it at the plate, two and two.
Sometimes the hits come so rapidly, too. Home run, double, bang, bang. You think it's time to take out a pitcher. Nice play by Jim Leiritz, coming up with either the splitter or a sinker.
This is the first time that Posada has ever faced Joey Hamilton. Two balls, two strikes, runner at third. Nobody out. 3-1 Padres in the seventh. One away and a big strikeout for Hamilton and San Diego.
Now, one scouting report on Joey Hamilton says he throws a turbo sinker. Look at the downward movement on that pitch. Throws it hard, gets a lot of movement. Posada, a good low ball hitter, but just can't catch up with that one.
Boy, that was a nasty, heavy sinker by Hamilton. Now with his work cut out for him because Chili Davis, and we've mentioned it more than once, a lethal low ball hitter.
He bats for Cone. David Cone, six innings, three runs, two earned. Two hits, that's it, but three walks, four strikeouts, and one important error behind him. Chili Davis. Spencer at third and one down here in the seventh. Strike one.
Well, Tim, you mentioned it. Chili Davis, a lethal low ball hitter. You see that flashing zone inside, over the heart of the plate, or outside. Chili Davis loves that ball down. Has a hard time catching up with the high fastball, however.
Problem is, to be effective, Hamilton's got to stay down in the strike zone.
Chili Davis, the tying run at the plate for the Yankees in the seventh. One ball, one strike. You can see with the radar reading on the Fox box, 95 miles per hour from Joey Hamilton. The 1-1 pitch. Over but low. Two balls and a strike. A leadoff home run by Scott Brosius on a 3-2 pitch. Followed up by the double by Shane Spencer. Pitching change. A pass ball. Runner at third. One out after the strikeout of Posada. And now time called as a beach ball. Gets loose. Out in left center field.
It gives the fans a chance to take a breath here.
Mendoza, the right-hander, Lloyd, the left-hander. They were up earlier, and one of those two will enter in the bottom of the seventh inning. Runner at third, one out. Chili Davis, the ground ball to the left side. Everyone will be safe, including Spencer at the plate. It's a one-run game, and you cannot convince me that Ken Caminiti is healthy. That makes it a 3-2 score as that ball got under the glove of Caminiti to his left.
You're right, Joe. Ken Caminiti usually sucks this ball up. He can't bend over. Goes under his glove, and had Gomez gotten to this ball, no play on Davis. So an infield hit drives in the run. But Ken Caminiti normally just sucks that ball right up.
You can see he's had his glove where the ball was. He just did not have the glove down on the ground.
Now Bruce Bochy will make the walk out of the San Diego dugout again. We have a pinch runner, Homer Bush at first, running for Chili Davis. He put the ball in play. It's an RBI for Chili Davis. They've ruled in an error on the part of Caminiti, which is rare because Caminiti did not get a glove on the ball. Typically, that's the qualifications for an error or a hit. Bruce Bochy has not signaled down to the San Diego bullpen as Randy Myers cranks it up for the Padres.
But you're not going to bring Myers in to pitch to Knobloch and Jeter. This is a strategic meeting on Homer Bush.
This may be a time to bring in Hernandez. You mentioned, Timmy, that normally when Hitchcock comes out of the game, so does Leyritz. And now in a running situation, Bruce Bochy is indeed going to bring in his better defensive catcher, Carlos Hernandez.
So the tying run at first with only one out. And the range of Caminiti and the error by Caminiti now. Talk about the error by O'Neill. The error by Caminiti puts the tying run on base for the Yankees here in the seventh. And the Yankees have a ton of speed over there now. And Homer Bush, the former member of this Padre organization, as Carlos Hernandez is now behind the plate, taking over for Jim Leyritz.
And no warm-up tosses of any kind for Carlos Hernandez. Unless he did it in the cage underneath the stadium, he's coming in there cold.
So the idea is if you're going to run on him, run early before he gets loose.
Tying run at first with one out.
And now in order for Hernandez to throw a couple more pitches, Joey Hamilton asks for a new baseball. Kind of a sly way of getting a couple of warm-up tosses for your catcher.
The old new baseball
for Chuck Knobloch at the plate. One out of three tonight. Homer Bush, the tying run at first with only one down. And the count goes to 2-0 on Knobloch. Well, we have talked time and time again about the middle relief of the San Diego Padres. Hamilton came in to a tough situation. The defense has not backed him up. Play by Caminiti hurts the Padres. But all of a sudden, it's a one-run game in the seventh inning with a tying run off. A strike from Hamilton. It's 2-1. Bruce Bochy desperately trying to get this game into the hands of Trevor Hoffman, a top candidate for the National League Cy Young Award and a closer for the Padres, who has yet to work in this series. 2-2 now on Knobloch.
Homer Bush with a fake break on that 2-1 pitch. I think that Joe Torre will probably wait for the count's 3-2 before he'll run him. Jose Cardenal just making sure with Homer.
That's the tying run, the go-ahead run at the plate. Chuck Knobloch, who has one home run in this World Series. block, floats it down the right field line. Long run for Gwynn. Can't get there, but it's foul.
Well, had Tony Gwynn been able to get to that ball, an easy double play for the Padres. Homer Bush off with the pitch as you get a look at Gwynn trying to track this ball down on the right field line. It's about 3 or 4 feet foul as Tony makes the sliding effort. Bunch of Padres middle infielders as they decoy Homer Bush into believing it's a ground ball double play. He's still looking at the infielders for the baseball.
That's why when you take two steps from first, you look back to see where the ball's being hit. Don't rely on the middle infielder.
The 2-2 inside 3-2, and you would think the Yankees would start Homer Bush at first. He's there with one out.
Bet your house on it.
Bet your house on it.
Good rates.
There he goes. Knobloch fouls it.
That time Joey Hamilton going with almost a quick pitch. Very quickly came set and delivered the ball to home plate trying to unload so Homer Bush could not get a big jump. The other alternative if you're a pitcher in this situation knowing he's going to run is to hold the ball. Hope to get him to jump early and then maybe pick him off at first base. That time Bush taking a peek back to home plate.
Runner goes. Knobloch takes ball four, and now the go-ahead run is on for the Yankees here in the seventh. A homer, a double, a pass ball, an error, and now a walk. One strikeout mixed in, and it's two on, one out, with Derek Jeter at the plate, who's walked, singled, struck out, and the left-hander O'Neill on deck.
This is a tough situation for Carlos Hernandez. Because in order to be effective, Hamilton has to keep the ball down, and if the runners run, then you're not in a position to make the good throw. Hernandez is going to talk to Hamilton now, and Joe Torre has a lot of options. You mentioned that hit and run. David Cone's not out there anymore. The last time Jeter was up, it was first and second. Now I think Joe Torre could go to a hit and run if Jeter gets the count in his favor.
Sterling Hitchcock started this night, started this inning. Jeter a little late. And we look at the outfield hits by direction on a hitter who likes to go the other way.
Very adept at what they call staying inside the ball. Doesn't get fooled very often, doesn't get out in front of pitches very often, and gets a lot of base hits the opposite way.
Play, inning over. Chris Gomez using every millimeter of that glove. The juggle, the double play, and a one-run Padre lead.
Thanks to your support, Course is celebrating 125 years.
From us to you, thanks.
Thanks a million.
Thanks for 125 years.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thanks for your support.
We appreciate it.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks for everything.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for making our beer your beer.
Protect the body. Ignite the soul. The new Volvo S80.
Breakthrough to the new world of Mach 3 from Gillette. The first triple blade shaving system. Three blades specially positioned to shave progressively closer. You take one stroke, it takes three. So you don't have to shave the same area over and over, which means less irritation. Three blades, fewer strokes, less irritation. Mach 3 from Gillette.
Recent reports of UFO sightings in the skies of the Fulton County have caused...
Car trouble, son?
Yeah, I was just on the internet and...
You did the internet on that phone?
Yeah, email, stock quotes, it's a pager too.
The Q phone, the most advanced palm-sized digital phone from Qualcomm.
Weird guy, cool phone.
Safer than any car we've ever built. As thrilling as any car anyone's ever built. The new Volvo S80.
The 1998 World Series on Fox is brought to you by MasterCard, official card of Major League Baseball and fan of the great American pastime. And by Qualcomm, leading manufacturer of wireless digital phones.
Back at Qualcomm Stadium, we move to the bottom of the seventh inning. And the new pitcher for the Yankees is the left-hander, Graham Lloyd. New battery altogether with new pitcher and catcher, Posada behind the plate, Finley to the right of the second baseman, Knobloch. Good play, one out. Chuck Knobloch with a strong play to his right. As we look at the numbers in this postseason for Graham Lloyd.
On that double play to end the top of the seventh inning, the two middle infielders for the Padres, Kilvio Varas, Chris Gomez, watch him decoying Homer Bush back to second. First Gomez moves in, then Varas moves in, and then Gomez able to make the play on the line drive, tip it up in the air, make the catch, and complete the double play.
All Graham Lloyd had to do was get one out. Joe Torre came out of the dugout, and we will see Mendoza when we come back.
Oh, hi, honey. Am I excited about Thursday? Of course, Thursday's our anniversary.
Of course I planned a trip.
Yeah, we're taking the Orient Express to a spot in Thailand for bird watching.
Love you too. Bye.
Visa Platinum.
To go to Thailand.
With a world of purchase power for the unexpected, including that trip you never thought you'd take.
This was such a surprise.
Yeah.
Visa Platinum. It's everywhere you want to be.
What's Anski?
What?
What the hell is Anski?
Oh, this. I didn't do good at all.
Slide back. Slide back. Sweat.
Oh, my yeah, what is that? There you go.
Nice, right?
Yanks.
Yanks.
Yanks! Oh. Let's go, guys!
Buy a set of four selected Goodyear tires before November 28th and get a $50 or $100 U.S. savings bond. For the retailer nearest you, call 1-800-GOODYEAR. Serious freedom.
Goodyear, Goodyear. Chow, chow, chow.
Samson's so healthy. Know why? Cat Chow has advanced nutrition with omega-6 fatty acids to help keep his immune system healthy inside, skin and coat healthy outside. Purina Cat Chow for a healthy cat.
Major League Baseball and Polygram Video present the Ultimate Series Souvenir, the official 1998 World Series home video. All the drama and excitement of the 1998 World Series, plus exclusive interviews, are showcased in this remarkable video. To order the official 98 World Series home video for $19.95 plus shipping and handling, use your credit card and call 1-800-243-1010. That's 1-800-243-1010. A message from Major League Baseball.
X-Files. The new season begins November 8th on Fox.
Welcome back to San Diego. This copyrighted telecast is presented by authority of the Commissioner of Baseball and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form, and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without expressed written consent. What a weapon the Yankees have to bring out of their bullpen. Even though it's getting late, they have Ramiro Mendoza. One out, nobody on, dealing with Carlos Hernandez. First at bat of the night, first pitch from Mendoza's strike one.
He will get a lot of ground balls. An over-the-top sinker, different from Joey Hamilton. Joey drops down about three quarters. Mendoza right over the top.
Right by Carlos Hernandez for strike two.
Like a hard splitter.
Carlos Hernandez took over for Jim Leyritz in the top of this seventh inning. Perez couldn't hold up. Nasty pitch from Mendoza, out number two.
Carlos tried to hold up, but just couldn't. That's that sinker just dying out of that strike zone.
So two out, nobody on for Chris Gomez. High chopper over the head of Brocious for a hit. Down the line, and Gomez is thinking too. Spencer comes up throwing. Gomez is out. To end the seventh inning. Shane Spencer guns down. Chris Gomez to end the seventh. We go to the eighth. 3-2 Padres.
We will hunt down the enemy, and we will kill the enemy.
FBI!
I want you to turn the heat up.
Their objective was the enemy.
We don't know who the terrorists are for sure.
Their methods were different.
I am declaring martial law in this city.
And our freedom.
Do you have any idea what you're starting?
Don't ever again question my command.
I'm not under your command.
Hangs in the balance.
You can't do this.
Right now, right here, I am the law.
The Siege, rated R. November 6th, only in theaters.
People smile and tell me I'm the lucky one. And we've just begun. Think I'm gonna have a son.
And in the morning when I rise, you bring a tear of joy to my eyes and tell me everything's gonna be alright.
Aflac, insuring over 40 million people worldwide.
Your investments help pay for this dream house. Unfortunately, it belongs to your broker. With the new E-Trade, the power is in your hands. The number one rated place to invest online. Now open free to the public with 10 times more research. Free real-time quotes, still from just $14.95 a trade. Sign up now and get $50 free. Hey, now the power's in your hands. E-Trade, someday we'll all invest this way.
Man, it's hot out there. Sports.
Seema.
Seema.
The season's breakout hit is back.
As God is my witness, there will be a party.
That 70s show Sunday after an all-new Simpsons Halloween special.
The Lost World with no scenes added, November 1st on Fox.
From Super Shot, you see Shane Spencer making the nice play, gets in a good position to throw. Great play at the other end by Chuck Knobloch. Watch him play this short hop. Get the tag back on the elbow of Chris Gomez before he's able to get to the bag.
And now Randy Myers takes over here in the eighth inning. Facing Paul O'Neill and missing with ball one.
Trevor Hoffman has not pitched in 6 days. He has not started the eighth inning in any game this year. But Bruce Bochy, if the Yankees come back to tie it, you're not going to be able to use Hoffman anyway. Hoffman up and throwing now.
Low 2-0 on Paul O'Neill.
Randy Myers struck out Paul O'Neill on four sliders on Sunday night at Yankee Stadium. But it's a different Paul O'Neill you're looking at because now he's seen Randy Myers once.
In this postseason, he has hit two home runs. And you hear it said quite a few times. Sometimes the save comes in the eighth inning. Maybe not statistically, but with a heart of the order here for the Yankees, it's Myers instead of Hoffman and a strike to Paul O'Neill with Williams and Tino Martinez to follow. Randy Myers has fallen behind on the count to Paul O'Neill, who tonight is 1-for-3. 2-2, with the Padres leading 3-2 here in the eighth.
Well, the Padres have had trouble getting the ball to Trevor Hoffman in this postseason. See what Hoffman has done as opposed to the rest of the bullpen for the San Diego Padres.
Off Hoffman getting ready, but right now it's Randy Myers on the mound with the Padres up by a run here in the eighth. And another beach ball gets loose out in the outfield to delay the action. Tony Gwynn will go to get it.
That's one sure way you know you're in San Diego and not Yankee Stadium. Beach balls instead of bowling balls flying out of the stands.
Paul O'Neill will get something away here.
Full count, 3-2.
We mentioned it the other night. Randy Myers does not have a pitch to left-handed batters that tails inside. So if you're a left-hander, you take the inside part of the plate away and look outside as Bernie Williams waits on deck.
Padres down 2-0. Leading here tonight in the eighth, 3-2. And a leadoff walk. The tying run is on as Paul O'Neill heads down to first. That is the third walk handed to the Yankees tonight. And now Bruce Bochy will come out and evidently make a double switch. He's got the pitcher spot due to lead off in the bottom of this eighth inning. Andy Sheets will come out, take over at short. Gomez is gone. And this place will shake when Trevor Hoffman comes in from the bullpen for San Diego. Myers is finished here in the eighth.
One official Major League Baseball, $9. New ball, $9. New ball, $9. New ball, new ball, new ball, $9. New windshield, $100. Making home run history, priceless. There are some things money can't buy. For everything else, there's MasterCard, official card of Major League Baseball and believer that records were made to be broken.
Taz. Looks like Taz just got his AT&T phone bill. Taz, don't you make a lot of calls on Sunday?
Yeah, Taz call.
Then use NCI 5-cent Sundays. It's just 5 cents a minute every Sunday. AT&T charges 3 times as much.
Taz, let's call 1-800-SUNDAYS. Become an NCI customer.
Batting next, Mark McGuire.
Did somebody say McDonald's? Oh, and you better make that to go.
Breakthrough to the new world of Mach 3 from Gillette. The first triple blade shaving system. 3 blades specially positioned to shave progressively closer. You take 1 stroke, it takes 3. So you don't have to shave the same area over and over, which means less irritation. 3 blades, fewer strokes, less irritation. Mach 3 from Gillette.
The scene as Trevor Hoffman came out of the Padre bullpen, and here he is, the closer, with a tying run at first, nobody out in the eighth inning for the Yankees.
53 saves on the year, and the big question is if he can pitch now to try to get 6 outs in the eighth and ninth, why didn't he start the inning?
During the regular season, Bruce Bochy regularly used Dan Mazzelli and Randy Myers to get to Trevor Hoffman, but this is not the regular season.
Tying run at first for the Yankees as Bernie Williams takes a strike.
Paul O'Neill at first base, a very smart base runner. 15 stolen bases in 16 tries. He tries to steal by timing the pitcher. Hoffman with a huge leg kick, easy to run on.
One ball, one strike.
You can see Hoffman right there, a slide step. And when you get a pitcher like that in a slide step, you're going to take something away from his normal delivery. That's another reason he should have started the inning.
You see that slide step, just barely picks the left foot up off the ground, unloads the ball quickly to home plate.
Outside corner, strike two.
Well, if O'Neill is thinking about running, this is the changeup situation for Trevor Hoffman when he normally goes to that devastating changeup. Good pitch to run on.
Time called, and while we have a moment, I'll tell you that the only player available now to Joe Torre who has faced Trevor Hoffman for the Yankees is Chad Curtis. Williams looking at him for the first time, and he has a 2-2 count. Girardi, the other, who has already been replaced in the lineup for New York tonight. Curtis watching from the bench as Bernie Williams, the cleanup hitter for the Yankees, bats with a tying run at first. Nobody out. Into right field, Gwynn back. At the track, feeling for the wall, the catch. O'Neill will stay put, one away. An anxious few seconds here in San Diego as that ball carried a long way off the bat of Bernie Williams.
Tony Gwynn goes all the way back to the wall, feels with his left hand to see how close he's getting, and at the same time, Steve Finley was streaking over from center field, letting Tony Gwynn know that the runner at first was tagging.
Kelby Alvarez with his back to the infield, unsure as to whether O'Neill was going to run or not. You can't hear anything down there. Tony Gwynn getting in the proper position to throw the ball and hit the cutoff man, but Barris's throw was errant.
Now Tino Martinez takes the strike.
Talk about that devastating changeup that Trevor Hoffman features, without a doubt his best pitch. An average fastball, a better than average curveball, three quality pitches, which is rare for a closer.
But that fastball becomes outstanding playing off the changeup as he misses low, one ball, one strike.
That's why, that's a very good point, Joe, because that's why it's important that he come in with nobody on. That way he can use his high leg kick that serves him well with both the fastball and the changeup. But he hadn't been using it because of the fear of O'Neill running.
One ball, one strike on Tino Martinez. Just missing the outside corner, 2-1.
Very close with this 1-1 fastball. Hernandez pulls it back a little bit. Can't buy a strike from Dale Scott behind the plate.
Tough to watch for some of these fans here in San Diego. The 2-1. Three balls and a strike. Martinez checked his swing. Tying run at first with only one out here in the eighth inning. Padres leading by a run, trailing by two games in the 1998 World Series. Hoffman behind on the count, 3-1. Ball four, and now the go-ahead run is on for the Yankees here in the eighth inning. Two walks. A walk by Myers to O'Neill leading off the inning after Williams flied to the track in right. Tino Martinez draws the walk, and now Scott Brosius bats. Brosius is two out of three, and he got the scoring started for the Yankees with that swing in the top of the seventh inning. A 3-2 pitch from Sterling Hitchcock. The Yankees would get another run, driven in by Chili Davis. They trail by one. Two on, one out, Brocious. Strike one.
First time we've seen the curveball from Trevor Hoffman. Get a look from over the top. Brocious well out in front of home plate as he tries to check his swing.
Brocious with 11 postseason RBIs for this Yankee team, leading the way. Hernandez kept it in front, one ball, one strike.
Fortunately, it was in front of Carlos Hernandez. Had it trickled off to the right or behind him, O'Neill goes to third base.
Boy, Hernandez has done a great job already catching Hoffman in this inning, keeping that change up in front. It's a relatively easy pitch to block because you anticipate it going in the dirt. Hernandez with perfect position that time.
Two on, one out, one ball, one strike. And another block by Hernandez to save a wild pitch. Two and one.
Now, when some guys are on the mound, you just know you have your work cut out for you behind home plate. And Carlos Hernandez has been a real dirt dog this inning.
Why is this eighth inning important? Outside of the obvious reasons for the Padres down two games to none, as Dave Stewart visits Trevor Hoffman. The Padres this season, including the playoffs, 92-0 when leading after eight, and dating back to July of 1996, 181-0 as we play here in the top of the eighth inning, and the Padres leading 3-2, but two on, one out for the Yankees, with O'Neill the lead runner at second, Tino Martinez on at first, both walked in this eighth, and Brocious, the Yankees' leading RBI man at the plate. And that's a big reason why. 5 out of 11 with runners in scoring position. Here he is with two on, one out. To the third baseman, foul, 2-2.
I think Dave Stewart may have gone out and told Hoffman to go back to the high leg kick. He had not used it with any consistency this inning, but that last pitch is more Trevor Hoffman-like with that high leg kick that helps, again, both his fastball, but particularly that changeup.
Now the 2-2 to Brocious. Into center field, well hit. Finley back at the track, at the wall. Three-run home run for Scott Brocious. And just like that, the Yankees take a 5-3 eighth inning lead. Brian Cashman, the Yankee general manager, trying his hardest not to root. And now with one out, nobody on, the batter is Ricky Lede off the bench to bat for Shane Spencer. The Yankee bench reaction as New York has taken the lead here by two in the eighth. Scott Brocious continues to stun, coming off a 203 season a year ago in Oakland. During the regular season, he drove in 98. At the bottom of the order, he has hit two home runs in this game, has four RBIs tonight, and has driven in 14 runs in the postseason for the Yankees. One out, nobody on. Three runs are in. Two balls and a strike. And Lede up the middle. Veras to his right. Good play for the second out of the inning. And you go back to what both you, Tim, and you, Bob, said starting this eighth inning. Why not Trevor Hoffman to start? It was Randy Myers, and the leadoff walk followed.
Well, it'd be a different story if you had used Trevor Hoffman in games one and two.
Yep.
But he's very well rested, perhaps too well rested, with 6 days off between appearances.
Two out, bases empty. And the batter's Posada takes ball one. These Yankees trying to continue their methodical march toward their 24th World Championship. Up two games to none. Now here in the eighth inning, up 5-3. One ball, one strike on Posada. Right back up the middle, and Trevor Hoffman is having his troubles with this Yankee lineup. He issued the one out walk after getting Williams to fly to the track. Then the 3-run home run hit by Brocious, and now a base hit up the middle with two out by Posada. She's watching now and not liking what she sees. With the Yankees leading by two in the eighth.
65,000 stunned folks here at Qualcomm Stadium.
Two blown saves for Trevor Hoffman in this postseason. You remember he blew the save in game one, the National League Championship Series, a game in which the Padres won on the 10th inning Ken Caminiti home run. Here's Mendoza, who obviously will stay in and pitch. The bottom of this eighth inning, he takes a strike. So this should be the out valve for Trevor Hoffman here in the eighth. And it's turned into a long eighth. Strike two. Seventh man to bat in the inning. To the shortstop, Andy Sheets. Fresh into the game, the throw to first, and Mendoza in his first major league at bat. Grounds to short. Big damage again. And again it's Scott Brocious into dead center field. The 3-run shot. It's 5-3. Yankees in the eighth.
I just went to use the phone.
You say once you got back, your wife was gone.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
What?
Have you checked the hot enchilada?
Oh, no. Millicent gets terrible heartburn.
Not this time.
What's that?
Looks like the remains of an individually wrapped Pepcid AC Chewable.
Introducing Pepcid AC Chewables, the first chewable to stop heartburn before it starts.
Millicent? Is that you?
Start living heartburn-free with new Pepcid AC Chewables.
What do you want out of life? What do you imagine it to be? We're American General Financial Group, helping over 12 million people live the life they've imagined with retirement plans, life insurance, and consumer loans. American General Financial Group. Live the life you've imagined.
Get ready to taste life for the first time, people.
Watch out now. You want to taste life? Then take a big swig of this new Pepsi One. This one's got it all. The most awesome cola taste that's bigger than the wild blue yonder. But only one calorie. You want to taste one?
Yeah.
You want one?
Yeah.
You want one?
Yeah.
Come and get it. Yeah.
You got one for me?
Put your tray table up and prepare for takeoff, my man.
New Pepsi One.
Murphy, I want you to pick my wife up from the airport. Her name is Thelma.
I'm Thelma.
Really?
Really.
Camry's extra value package with CD player and six speakers and a power driver's seat.
Thanks for the ride.
No problem, Mrs. Burns.
Who's Mrs. Burns?
Did we mention anti-lock brakes? The 1999 Camry. At least the road will be smooth.
The 1998 World Series on Fox is brought to you by Brewery Fresh Budweiser, the official beer of Major League Baseball, and by Toyota. Get the most out of your day every day.
High above, the Goodyear blimp Eagle has been providing aerial pictures all night long. At the controls, pilot Joel Chamberlain. 1998 is the 100th anniversary of Goodyear and the 73rd for its blimp fleet. The camera operator is Glenn Hampton. Up above, sure it's nice and quiet. Down below, it got awful quiet after the home run hit by Brocious. Andy Sheets will lead it off for San Diego, and they trail 2-0 and 5-3 in the bottom of the eighth. Ramiro Mendoza is trying to do for the Yankees what the middle relief hasn't been able to do for the Padres, and that is get the ball in the hand of their closer in the ninth inning. Strike two quickly on Andy Sheets with Kilvey Alvarez and Tony Gwynn to follow.
Well, Mendoza is an ideal setup man because of that hard sinker and the hard slider. Everything is down. It's hard to hit the ball in the air against this guy. Very rarely will give up a home run late in the game.
Still 0-2 on Andy Sheets. First at bat, took over in the double switch in the top of this eighth inning. Trevor Hoffman with a blown save. Sheets takes it high. It is a blown save, even though it came in the eighth inning. Randy Myers will be charged for the one run, the tying run to score, and Hoffman is on the hook right now. The 1-2 pitch to Brocious. Ball throw is perfect. Scott Brocious hit the home run to put the Yankees out in front. Here's Padre hitting instructor and former Oakland A's coach Merv Rettman after the home run.
You know, our reports on him, Brocious is a great breaking ball hitter. Enough. But in Oakland, you know what he used to be? The best fastball hitter in the organization. He could hit a heater. Man, that ball was crushed.
He's hit two high fastballs tonight for home runs.
Ooh, that came up and hit Varus like it caught him in the face on the foul ball, and the count 0-2. The heart of the order will bat again tonight for the Padres. As we take another look at this painful strike.
Yeah, the flap's on the right side, and Kilbio had the ball come up on the left flap. Appears to be all right.
Now the 0-2. Varus into left center field. Well hit. Lede will not get there. One hop up against the wall. Kilvey Alvarez has a one-out double. And it looks like that'll be all for Mendoza. Joe Torre points down to the Yankee bullpen, and he points at the New York closer. Mariano Rivera will enter here in the bottom of the eighth inning with the tying run win at the plate.
Breakthrough to the new world of Mach 3 from Gillette, the first triple blade shaving system. Three blades specially positioned to shave progressively closer. You take one stroke, it takes three. So you don't have to shave the same area over and over, which means less irritation. Three blades, fewer strokes, less irritation. Mach 3 from Gillette.
Introducing AT&T 5-Cent Weekends.
Perfect. Perfect. No. Perfect.
Now calls from home on weekends anytime, anywhere are just 5 cents a minute.
Perfect.
So get comfy, because weekends have never been better.
I take my calling very seriously.
To get 5-Cent Weekends, call now to enroll.
Hello?
a snowflake falls at the far end of history. And that snowflake, we'll call him Steve, winds up as part of a droplet of water. And one day, that droplet, Steve's droplet, could wind up in a brewery where a man you'll never meet discovers the perfect temperature to frost-brew beer. And like that, Steve is in a Coors Light can, and then a tray, and a cup. And now, he's here with you. So I ask you, gentle stranger, do not spill, Steve. Coors Light!
This is a lonely place when there are no fans. The world's a lonely place when you have a secret. If your secret is that you're being sexually abused, don't be ashamed. You're not alone. Talk to a teacher, a police officer, or call this number for help. You don't even have to give your name if you don't want to. This isn't a game. It's your life.
Well, tomorrow it's game four, and we'll be right back here as the Yankees and the Padres continue to battle for the World Championship. It's game four, the World Series. 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific time, only on Fox. But right now, it's game three. And it's a 5-3 Yankee lead in the bottom of the eighth inning with the Padres down 2-0. Mariano Rivera out of the Yankee bullpen.
Two totally different pitchers. Mendoza, who throws the sinker, and Rivera, who throws the cutter and the high fastball. So the Padres have to change their thinking. With Mendoza, you had to make him get the ball up. With Rivera, you have to make him get the ball down.
Well, the hitter at the plate is very familiar with making adjustments on the fly.
That's right.
Tony Gwynn. Runner at second is Veras, tying run at the plate here in the eighth inning. And a fastball poured in there for strike one. The opposite way, falling in a hurry. LeDay won't get there. Base hit. It's first and third. One out for the Padres in the eighth. That was the first at bat for Tony Gwynn against Mariano Rivera. And here's the scouting report on the hard throwing right-hander.
That explosive high fastball you were talking about, Tim. And also it comes from a very deceptive, easy motion after making him get the ball down in the zone.
Well, Gwynn gets the hit to put the tying run on. And with Mariano Rivera on the mound, his cousin Ruben Rivera comes off the Padres bench to run for Gwynn. And Greg Vaughn, the top run producer for the Padres in 1998, digs in. 0 for 3 tonight. Three home runs in the postseason. Vaughn trying to launch one. Strike one.
You would think that if Greg Vaughn does launch one, as this foul tip is off the shoulder of Jorge Posada, right up under the neck, he appears to be all right. But you would think that if Vaughn does launch one, it's going to be to right field. Rivera throws so hard, he throws that cut fastball away and the high fastball. I don't think Vaughn will be pulling Mariano Rivera.
Nothing and one the count. Two big swings by Vaughn, the count 0-2.
Posada's got to feel this is a personal thing. Two pitches, two foul balls off the mask as we get a look at Greg Vaughn's hit zone. He's had a couple of good rips at fastballs in that red area right down the heart of the plate.
Vaughn 0-3 in his career against Mariano Rivera. Hit 50 home runs during the regular season. Three big swings by Vaughn, and he's just gotten a piece of each of the first three from Rivera.
A Posada out to have a word with his closer here. Shook off a slider to throw another inside fastball. Vaughn with another great rip at a pretty good pitch.
However, the cuts and pitches like this, the high fastball, not as dangerous as they appear, even though that one was down more in the zone. That was initially thrown. I thought it was up a little bit more, but that was about belt high. Try to go up the ladder, does Rivera. Very difficult pitch to lay off of.
Center field. Back is O'Neill. Tagging is Veras. He will score to make it a one-run game. It's 5-4 Yankees here in the eighth.
Cut fastball on the outside part of the plate. Greg Vaughn tracking the flight of that ball, wishing it would go further.
The reaction of Kevin Towers, who thought that ball would carry a little further than it did. Vaughn still staring out into right center field where O'Neill came up with it, and now with a tying run at first, Ruben Rivera. Mariano Rivera works to Ken Caminiti.
See, that's what that cutter does. You could see it just dart a bit, about 2 or 3 inches late to Greg Vaughn, and really it cuts away from the, and that was another one right there, it cuts away from the fat part of the bat to the end, and that's where Vaughn hit it, on the end of the bat.
A little low, 1-1.
Posada with a cannon behind the plate, one of the better throwers in baseball. 40% of the runners were caught. Rivera with great speed at first base.
Caminiti fouled that one off his front leg. Down in a heap on strike two.
Going back inside, you see where Posada is set up. Rivera hits the target. Caminiti fouls that ball off his leg.
Right off the knee.
Bob, I think in this situation, this is a running count. If you're thrown out at second base, Caminiti leads off the bottom of the ninth inning. You've got to take a chance against this team.
Mariano checks on Ruben during the regular season. 5 out of 6 stealing bases was Ruben Rivera.
Have to be mindful of the pitch out, however, ahead in the count 1-2.
Struck him out, and Caminiti ends up seated at home plate as Mariano Rivera comes in, allows one inherited runner to score, and we move to the ninth. Yankees lead by 1.
Your investments help pay for this dream house. Unfortunately, it belongs to your broker. With the new E-Trade, the power is in your hands. The number one rated place to invest online. Now open free to the public with 10 times more research. Free real-time quotes, still from just $14.95 a trade. Sign up now and get $50 free. Hey, now the power's in your hands. E-Trade, someday we'll all invest this way.
Water must be cold.
Papa John says they have better ingredients. They want you to think their tomato sauce is fresh. But what they don't tell you is Papa John's sauce is made from canned, pre-cooked, processed tomato sauce. They get their mushrooms out of a can, too, packed with preservatives. You won't find canned mushrooms at Pizza Hut.
but you will find the Sicilian pizza with garlic, basil, and oregano baked right into the crust. Now just $8.99 for a Supreme Sicilian. Pizza Hut, the best pizzas under one roof.
Out here, you don't worry about running out of gas. You worry about running out of dirt.
It's the biggest Halloween special ever.
He's entering the terrible twos, all right.
An all-new Simpsons, part of a full hour. Fox Sunday starting at 7:30, 6:30 Central.
Again, thanks to all of our friends at Goodyear for this shot. Qualcomm Stadium in San Diego. The score 5-4. Yankees leading. Kevin Brown seated on that dugout bench. Good chance that he will start in game four tomorrow night. Right now it's game three and it's the ninth inning, and Trevor Hoffman misses with a ball to Chuck Knobloch. Knobloch one out of three with a single and a walk. Jeter will follow, and then O'Neill. One ball, one strike. At the end of tonight's game, Bob, Tim, and I will select the Chevy Truck Player of the Game. Right now, it's Brocious in a landslide. He's hit two home runs and driven in four of the five Yankee runs tonight. 2-1 on Knobloch. And one on Knobloch is Trevor Hoffman with all of that rest. Hasn't worked since game six. The NLCS in Atlanta just closing out the win, the clinching victory. Not been his sharp self here tonight as Knobloch pops it into right. That's Rivera back to get it, one away. Ruben Rivera stays in the game in right field. Taking over for Tony Gwynn on the bases, and now defensively, Joe Torre managed the St. Louis Cardinals from 1990 until part of 1995. And right at the end of his time in a Cardinal uniform as manager, Joe Torre and his Cardinals lost 13 in a row here in San Diego. At the time, those were less than dominating San Diego Padre teams. So here he is back in a Yankee uniform. New York three outs away from a thrilling come-from-behind victory.
Yeah, Joe Torre has managed against 28 of the 30 Major League teams. The only teams against whom he has not managed, the Arizona Diamondbacks and the Yankees. And San Diego has been his worst opponent as a manager.
Jeter to the shortstop Sheets. Two out. The Padres in the bottom of the ninth inning. They'll be trailing by at least one run and facing Mariano Rivera. We'll have Joyner, Finley, and then Carlos Hernandez, the scheduled hitter. With a left-handed bench of Sweeney, Vanderwall, and Greg Myers left for Bruce Bochy. Here's Paul O'Neill. Five for the Yankees lead here in game three. To the outside corner to O'Neill. Paul O'Neill led off the eighth inning. Drew a walk, but it was not against Trevor Hoffman. It was against the left-hander, Randy Myers. And that's when the trouble began. That eighth inning for the Yankees, it was a leadoff walk, the pitching change. Fly ball caught at the track off the bat of Williams. A walk. And a three-run pop from Scott Brosius. O'Neill way out in front. Strike two.
Change up in the dirt. National League hitters have been waving at that pitch all summer long.
Hoffman trying to keep it a one-run game. Two and two.
Well, depending on how the bottom of the inning unfolds, you can be pretty sure you're going to see Greg Myers hitting for Carlos Hernandez. Myers, one of the few guys that has a history against Mariano Rivera, 3-for-7 lifetime.
The 2-2 to O'Neill, reaching for it, and the ground ball to Joyner. Top of the ninth inning, over. Wally Joyner will lead off the bottom of the ninth inning with Finley and then Hernandez, the scheduled hitters. Yankees lead 5-4.
Start feeling connected. Stop feeling everything. Start feeling the road. Introducing Alero, featuring the active response system. Alero by Oldsmobile. Start something.
French, German.
You're the genius behind the new Speak in a Week foreign language CDs. But can you say global distribution? You know linguistics, not logistics. Entree UPS. The same people you rely on here clear customs electronically and deliver to over 200 countries worldwide. Soon orders are rolling in and everyone's speaking your language.
Bonjour. Machine of war.
UPS. Moving at the speed of business.
Step up. Learn to see farther. Learn there are teachers who won't allow you to fail. Learn to dance, to draw. Learn that the real challenge doesn't come from the outside, but from within. And that there's more to you than you ever knew. Be all you can be.
The most evil souls in history have escaped from the devil.
He screwed up, and now I need someone to fix things.
Now, one man must hunt them down or return to hell himself. And you thought your job was tough. Peter Horton, Grimstone, premieres Friday at 8, 7 Central on Fox.
How dominating have the Yankees been when leading after 8, including the postseason? 111-1. The main reason is the man on the mound, Mariano Rivera. Before we start this bottom of the ninth inning with the Yankees leading 5-4, to revisit the top of the eighth, we talked about the difference in Trevor Hoffman not starting the eighth inning, coming in with a tying run on in a one-run game, and Hoffman was ineffective in that eighth inning. Gave up the lead, and all of a sudden the Padres find themselves down by 2-1 now.
Short relievers, when you talk to them, they don't mind cleaning up their own messes, but the way they make their money is not cleaning up the mess of somebody else. And with Paul O'Neill on at first, Trevor Hoffman was not allowed to take that high leg kick. I think that that was one of the things, the fear of Paul O'Neill running and the inability to get that high leg kick. By the time he did it against Brosius, it was ineffective.
Wally Joyner at the plate, 5-4 Yankees in the ninth inning. And a little broken bat, pop up, Jeter one away. And the Yankees are two outs away from taking the first three games of this World Series. That'll bring in Steve Finley. In case you're wondering, hit 14 home runs during the regular season.
This figures to be the most dangerous hitter Rivera faces here in the bottom of the ninth inning. Finley, a very good fastball hitter, a dead pull hitter, and likes the high fastball as well.
A strike over the inside corner from Rivera.
Yeah.
Finley to the right side. The Yankees are one out away from taking the first three games. Great teams hurt you throughout the game. Great teams don't get a lead and quit. They don't fall behind and quit. And Joe Torre's Yankees in this series have scored 12 runs after the first six innings.
Padres had a three-run lead in game one. The Knobloch home run, a three-run shot, and then Tino Martinez with a grand slam. And a three-run lead tonight. Bob, I agree with you. I think, Greg Myers is there on the bench and at least has some successful track record against Rivera.
But it's Carlos Hernandez instead. The last hope for the Padres to extend this ninth inning. Ball one from Rivera. The Yankees won game one, 9-6. They won game two, 9-3. Hernandez, the base hit into left field, and now the tying run is on. So Carlos Hernandez gets the base hit to extend it. And you almost see a pinch hitter here.
You're going to see a pinch runner, too. It could be George Arias, I would think. If you do pinch run, then you're down to your last catcher. But you have to. John Vanderwall is one of your better pinch hitters. So why would you use him as a pinch runner instead of a guy like Arias? Could be your 25th guy.
Or even use a pitcher, somebody that you feel confident won't hurt you on the base paths. Somebody that's got decent speed. Mark Sweeney's going to be the pinch hitter, a left-handed bat. Very much a first pitch hacker.
Well, if you think about it, I mean, even using Sweeney as the pinch runner, John Vanderwall's one of your best hitters against right-handed pitching.
So Vanderwall is the tying run at first with two out. Sweeney is the pinch hitter. And he gets a base hit into right field. Vanderwall will take the turn, head to third, and now the tying run is 90 feet away. And Andy Sheets is going to walk to the plate with first and third, two out.
Boy, very puzzling.
Yeah, it is. It is.
Unless there's an injury to Greg Myers that we don't know about. This really is a head scratcher right here.
Well, again, if you use a pitcher or George Arias, anybody, but John Vanderwall, then you have Vanderwall to pinch hit for Andy Sheets.
And he has been one of the best pinch hitters in the game the past three, 4 years, mainly with Colorado.
Then you could leave Arias, if they do tie it, leave Arias in the game to play shortstop.
Greg Myers is left. George Arias is left. And this game is going to come down to Andy Sheets against Mariano Rivera. There's the tying run. John Vanderwall at third. Potential winning run across the way. Mark Sweeney at first. And it's Sheets at the plate for the second time tonight. Strike one.
That was a very good cut by Andy Sheets. I think on a short pass ball or a short wild pitch, be alive if you're the runner on third.
Another good swing, but it's 0-2, and the Padres are down to their final strike. Again, John Vanderwall came in to pinch run. Sweeney got the base hit. Myers is still on the bench, and it's Andy Sheets at the plate. Nothing and two the count. Mariano Rivera trying to finish off the Padres in game three. Ball and two strikes. Tying run at third with two out. sheet stays alive at 1-2. A hit ties this game. An out ends game three. Game over, and the Yankees have won the first three games of the 1998 World Series. So with the Padres' best pinch hitter, pinch running, and standing at third, Andy Sheets strikes out to end game three. Mendoza gets the victory. The loser is Hoffman, the save for Rivera, his fifth of this postseason. And Scott Brosius is tonight's Chevy Truck Player of the Game.
I think that last move that Bruce Bochy made, the most puzzling move of the night, pinch running Vanderwall and having Andy Sheets have to face this.
Greg Myers sitting on the bench, John Vanderwall standing at third, and the Yankee dugout exploding onto the field. The reaction of Scott Brosius. He hits two home runs tonight, drives in four of the five Yankee runs, and the Yankees have won the first three games of this series. There's got to be a lot of head shaking right now on the part of the Padres and their fans. Right now, we take you down to Chip Carey standing by with Scott Brosius.
Joe, thank you very much. Scott, every kid's dream, I guess, to be the hero in a World Series game. Two home runs tonight. How about that?
There's nothing more fun than this. I mean, this is what you grew up dreaming about doing, and to play a big part in tonight just feels great.
Is it the man or is it the uniform? Last year with Oakland, you hit 203. Now with the Yankees, you drive in 98 runs and you help them win game three.
Well, certainly coming over here was just like a shot of adrenaline for me to come over and know that we had a chance to win over here. And like I said, this is what you play for. When you grow up, you want to go, you know, have a chance to get the World Series and play. So this whole year has just been great for me.
What's it like to play for a team that's now won 124 games and is on the cusp of another World Series championship?
Well, it feels good. Like I said, we'd like to get 125, and it'll feel real good. But we're in a good spot right now. We just want to go out, bear down, and try to get that last one.
Take us through the at bat, the home run against Trevor Hoffman.
Well, you know, Trevor, he's just the type of pitcher, you know, you're just going to have to battle and hope you get a pitch to hit. And, he threw one fastball earlier that I kind of was out in front of and fouled off. And he came back to another one. I stayed back on a little bit better.
Well, Scott, congratulations. Two home runs tonight. 3-0. The Yankees have the World Series lead. We'll see you tomorrow.
All right. Thanks a lot.
All right. Scott Brosius, the hero of game three for New York. Joe Buck, back to you upstairs.
All right, Chip. Thank you. And thank you to Scott Brosius for joining us. The hero from McMinnville, Oregon, Scott Brosius. What a postseason. He just keeps continuing to pound the baseball tip.
Now 7-for-12 in the series with five RBIs and two home runs. As we said in game one, this Yankee lineup, they can bite you from anywhere.
Yeah, a lot of very puzzling moves tonight on the part of Bruce Bochy. We mentioned a lot of moves that he would normally make during the regular season. But this is not the regular season.
It started with bringing in Myers to start the eighth inning, the three-run eighth inning for the Yankees, and it ended with Vanderwall, his best pinch hitter, standing at third as Andy Sheets struck out to end the game. Fox Sports coverage. The 1998 World Series continues with game four from San Diego at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, tomorrow night. For Tim McCarver, Bob Brenly, Chip Carey, and Steve Lyons, I'm Joe Buck from San Diego, where the New York Yankees have taken a 3-0 lead in the 1998 World Series. They have won 124 games. They get to 125. The Yankees will have 24 World Championships in their storied history. It's game four tomorrow night. We expect to see Kevin Brown against Andy Pettit. Hope you join us. Good night from San Diego.
This has been a presentation of Fox Sports, where legends are made, where champions are crowned, where dreams come true. Fox Sports, home of the 1998 World Series and Super Bowl XXXIII.